Just press continue on that.
So we can start now. A very warm welcome to all of you to today's discussion on democracy, dissent, and draconian laws. We are discussing should UAPA and sedition have a place in our statute books. We are all witness to what is happening in the country. Voices of dissent are being attacked. There is an attempt to stifle and silence those who dissent, and there is a direct attack on democratic rights of people. So today's discussion is being organized by the Campaign for Judicial Accountability and Reforms and by the Human Rights Defenders Alert. The HRDA India is one of the largest platforms in the country, which is helping human rights defenders overcome the daunting challenges from state and non-state actors. And the Campaign for Judicial Accountability and Reform, CJAR, is a campaign of different people's movements and campaigns which are working across the country on issues of public interest, who have come together in the hope of creating a judiciary which is more accountable, which is more sensitive and more accessible to people everywhere. It is our hope and our endeavor to take this very important issue to as wide an audience as possible. And we have today joining us on Zoom and through Facebook many people who live in bastis, who live in villages across the country as well, who are interested in this issue very deeply because they understand that it impacts all of them somewhere. So we will be doing a very brief translation into Hindi of everything that is spoken. We understand that the speakers will speak in English, but we will do a very short translation subsequently. And we will also be, we hope to translate this into regional languages so that there can be wide circulation of everything that's spoken today, and we will circulate it in different states. तो आज की चर्चा में आप सभी का स्वागत है. हम सब जानते हैं कि देश में क्या हालात हैं. जो लोग सरकार की नीतियां जो हैं, जो कि अन्याय को और असमानता को बढ़ाती हैं, उसके खिलाफ आवाज़ उठा रहे हैं, ऐसे कानूनों के खिलाफ आवाज़ उठा रहे हैं, उनकी आवाज़ों को कुचलने का एक प्रयास हम देखते हैं ऐसे कानूनों का इस्तेमाल करते हुए, जैसे कि देशद्रोह और यूएपीए, जिसको हम यूआपा कहते हैं, और ऐसे कानूनों का इस्तेमाल बहुत ही जबरदस्त तरीके से सरकारें कर रही हैं. और उसी के ऊपर आज डिस्कशन के लिए हम सब लोग जुड़े हैं, और हमारे साथ एक बहुत ही वरिष्ठ पैनल है रिटायर्ड जस्टिसेस का. हम उनसे अंग्रेजी में बात सुनेंगे, वो अपनी बात रखेंगे, और उसके बाद एक छोटा अनुवाद हिंदी में जब वो बोल लेंगे उसके बाद हम लोग करेंगे. मैं सबसे पहले प्रशांत भूषण को निमंत्रित करती हूँ कि वो सीजार की ओर से हमें बताएं कि आज की जो डिस्कशन है उसका कॉन्टेक्स्ट क्या है, और इंट्रोड्यूस भी करें सभी पैनलिस्ट को. सो आई रिक्वेस्ट प्रशांत भूषण, हु इज द कन्वीनर ऑफ द कैंपेन फॉर जुडिशियल अकाउंटेबिलिटी एंड रिफॉर्म्स, टू प्लीज गिव अस द कॉन्टेक्स्ट for this discussion and also introduce our panel of speakers today. Prashant, over to you.
Thank you, Anjali. I welcome everyone to this very historic webinar on one of the most pressing issues of our times. I am especially grateful and thankful to the five judges who have agreed to be part of this discussion: Justice Aftab Alam, Justice Gopala Gowda, Justice Madan Lokur, Justice Deepak Gupta, and Justice Anjana Prakash. They are among the most outstanding and the most respected judges of the country today, who have retired from the judiciary, but who are very, very important and outspoken voices for society in this country. The issue that we will be discussing, that they will be discussing today, is undoubtedly one of the most pressing issues of our times, which has a very, very central bearing on civil liberties and human rights. As Anjali told you, we are going through unprecedented times when laws like the UAPA and sedition are being used to stifle dissent and crush the freedom of speech. And therefore, the time has come for us to examine these laws and see whether such laws are still needed, whether such laws are in tune with the principles and the basic structure of our constitution. And there can be nobody better than these five retired judges who are in our panel today to discuss this and give their views about these issues. So without much ado, I would respectfully invite them to speak. Main thoda sa Hindi mein keh dun ki dekhiye ye bahut aitihasik webinar hai. एक ऐसे मुद्दे पर जो कि आज हमारे देश में हमारे समाज में बहुत ही अहम मुद्दा है, क्योंकि यूएपीए और सेडिशन जैसे कानून का आज इस्तेमाल जो लोग सरकार के साथ इत्तेफाक नहीं रखते, उनकी नीतियों के खिलाफ, उनके काम के खिलाफ आवाज़ उठाते हैं, उनके खिलाफ किया जा रहा है, उनकी आवाज़ बंद करने के लिए, और हमारा मौलिक अधिकार जो फ्रीडम ऑफ स्पीच का है उसको क्रश करने के लिए. तो इससे आज बेहतर अपॉर्चुनिटी और बेहतर समय और बेहतर लोग नहीं हो सकते हिंदुस्तान में जो आज हमारे पैनलिस्ट हैं, जो इसके ऊपर अपनी राय रखेंगे सेडिशन और यूएपीए के कानून के ऊपर, कि क्या ये हमारे संविधान से मेल खाते हैं, क्या हमारे लोकतांत्रिक समाज में इस तरह के कानूनों की ज़रूरत है, क्या खामियां हैं, क्या इसमें मुश्किलें हैं, इन सब पर अपनी राय रखेंगे. तो मैं आप सबका स्वागत करता हूं, और मैं पहले जस्टिस आलम को रिक्वेस्ट करता हूं कि वो शुरुआत में अपनी राय इस पर रखें. थैंक यू.
बहुत शुक्रिया प्रशांत भूषण साहब और सारे सुनने वाले. हम अपनी बातें अंग्रेजी में करेंगे जैसा कि यह है, लेकिन जैसा कि मिस भारद्वाज और प्रशांत भूषण जी ने आपको बताया, मेरी जो बातें हैं उसका मुख्तसर अनुवाद करके आप तक पहुंचाया जाएगा, और हमको बहुत खुशी होगी अगर मेरी बातों से आपको मौजूदा हालात को समझने में कुछ मदद मिलेगी. अगर मेरी बातें आपके किसी काम आएंगी तो हमको इस बात की बड़ी खुशी होगी. अब हम अपना मजमून आपके सामने पेश करते हैं जो कि अंग्रेजी में है. इन टुडे सेशंस डियर पार्टिसिपेंट्स, आई प्रपोज टू बिगिन विद अ परफॉर्मेंस ऑडिट ऑफ द यूएपीए बिफोर आई शेयर विद यू सम ब्रॉड थॉट्स ऑन द एक्ट. माय ऑडिट इज बोथ फ्रॉम द पर्सपेक्टिव ऑफ द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल गारंटी ऑफ लिबर्टी एंड फ्रॉम द पर्सपेक्टिव ऑफ नेशनल सिक्योरिटी एंड अटेम्प्ट्स टू सी हाउ द एक्ट एज इट प्लेज आउट इन रियल लाइफ fares in securing the latter without impinging upon the former. One of the criticisms of the UAPA is that with its very low rate of conviction but high rates of pendency, it is the process that becomes the punishment. The National Crime Records Bureau's last report is for the year 2019, and for that year it shows conviction rates under crime head UAPA at the relatively high rate of 29.2%. How is this conviction rate arrived at? It's quite simple. In 2019, there were 2,361 UAPA cases pending trial. 113 were disposed of with the following breakup: conviction in 33 cases, acquittals in 64 cases, and discharge in 16 cases. Thus, as you can see, the rate of conviction at 29.2% is against the number of cases disposed of in a single year, 113 cases divided by 33. If examined against the total number of cases registered or total number of persons arrested, then the rate of conviction comes down to the more realistic figure of just around 2%. And the pendency rate for UAPA cases increases to almost 98%. These are court disposal rates which are quite well known. But perhaps not so well known is the police disposal rates that refer to completion of investigation. For UAPA cases, the Bureau's report shows charge sheeting rate at 42.5% and pendency rate at 77.8%. With such low rates of disposal and such high pendency, both at the investigation and the trial stages, it is no surprise that though the case might finally fail, the accused would come out of incarceration only after 8, 10, or in some cases, even after 12 years. The case fails, the case ultimately has no legs to stand, but the accused has suffered. The accused has suffered jail for 8 years, 10 years, and 12 years. It is therefore not incorrect to say that in UAPA cases, the process itself is the punishment. At this point, it may be worthwhile to ask a question from a purely national security angle. Are these police disposal rates commensurate with dedicated legal framework that gives extraordinary powers to investigating agencies and suspends several fundamental and statutory rights of accused persons? Additionally, the NIA Act provides for a dedicated agency to respond to acts and conspiracies that have a bearing on national security. Surely these figures need more debate and accountability. On the face of it, however, it seems these special laws and dedicated agencies fail to carry out quick and focused investigations in UAPA cases. We must then ask whether the results justify the high toll on constitutional freedoms that this legal framework is based upon. One may recall here the Mumbai terror attack case. The attack had taken place when UAPA was yet to undergo the amendments of the year 2008, 2012, and 2009, making it more and more stringent. The attack was truly an international terrorist attack within the meaning of the UN resolutions that came to be later cited in the Amendment Act of 2008 as justification for making a stringent act still harsher. The attack had taken place from 26th to 29th November 2008, and the investigation, trial, appeals before the High Court and finally before the Supreme Court were all over by 29th August 2012. The judgments of the courts show that the investigation and the trials were held in full compliance with the constitutional guarantees under Articles 20, 21, and 22 that are grafted on the different provisions of the CRPC. The terror attack, apart from the devastation in terms of killing of innocent people and massive destruction of properties, also led to, in an indirect and intangible way, some very harmful consequences for the country's criminal justice system. In a knee-jerk reaction, within a month of the attack, amendments were made in the UAPA that have far-reaching consequences. The amendments enlarged the meaning of Terrorist Act and added to the Act procedural sections 43A to 43F. Section 43D2 made it possible for the investigating agency to have the period of investigation extended till 180 days while the accused remained in detention. And Section 43D, 4 and 5 made it next to impossible for the accused to get bail. A few days ago, I came across a fine article by Ms. Farhan Naqvi describing how Act 35 of 2008 was passed in Parliament and how ironically its most stringent provisions were portrayed as some wonderful gift to the nation. With regard to the extended period for investigation, it was declared in the Parliament with pride, and I quote from Ms. Naqvi's article, "We have made a provision of 180 days under this law. Our laws are more tough than that of America and England. Can you give me the example of any other country where such laws exist?" This was this there is an extract from a speech in the parliament in support of extending the investigation period to 180 days. On the other hand, and around the same time, in the aftermath of the London terror attack of July 2007, when the British Parliament voted on a proposal to increase the time for pressing of charges from 14 days to 90 days, and only for terror-related offences, it was defeated by a resounding majority, and the proposed amendment was considered, and I quote, a travesty to human liberty. They settled for a period of 28 days as temporary measure to be annually reviewed and reverted back to 14 days in 2012. This begs the question, how does one define a strong state? One with rhetorical statements about national security, polemical debates, and reduced accountability, or the other available modes which are accountable, conform to certain standards of civil liberties, and yet manage to perform perhaps better? The above example from our own parliament suggests that we are willing to rob our people of their personal freedom far more than any other country, without anything to show for it and without any accountability. It is really quite distressing that what should have been a matter of acute embarrassment was being proclaimed with great pride. But that is the art of making dangerous laws. As to provisions regarding the grant of bail, we see today the courts are struggling to overcome the barriers introduced in the Act for granting bail in cases that are seemingly unfounded and false. To my mind, Section 43(d)(4) and 5 appear to compromise the fundamental principle of the criminal law regarding the innocence of the accused. Further, if the restrictions contained in those provisions are sought to be applied to the powers of the High Court or the Supreme Court, as it seems being done, then I feel the constitutional validity of those provisions may become doubtful. Justice Anjana Prakash, one of the panelists today, has very effectively developed and elaborated the point in some of her presentations. Sorry. Unfortunately, the matter did not end with the amendments of 2008, and the Act has undergone further amendments in 2012 and again in 2019. As a result of the amendments of 2019, now an individual person can also be labeled a terrorist without any prior hearing. UAPA is indeed not the only law that inverses the burden of proof at the stage of grant of bail. Several special laws like NDPS, POCSO, and PMLA, before its provisions were read down by the SC, also have similar provisions and are liable to misuse. However, these acts still require the existence of a prima facie and a specific case against the accused. It is here that the UAPA stands out. Its nebulous and sweeping definitions require next to nothing to allege a prima facie case of unlawful or even terrorist activity, something perhaps as trivial as having in one's possession a copy of War and Peace may be cited as evidence of supporting terrorism. A useful insight into how UAPA is intended to operate is also provided by examining how violence is sought to be viewed and presented by the state. Is violence categorized as crime by an individual or as crime by specific groups? Do state reports address the structural causes of conflict and violence at all? The NCRB's report dealing with cases during the periods 2000, 2004 and 2001-2005 do not have any data on cases under POTA or UAPA, but the report has a chapter in which violent crimes are classified under different heads: violent crimes affecting life, violent crimes affecting property, violent crimes affecting public safety, violent crimes affecting women. The offenses are then further classified, and one of the subheads is motives of murder. And this is both interesting and important. With regard to the cases for years 2001-2005, it reads as under. The prominent motives behind murders were personal vendetta or enmity and property dispute as in the past. The other significant causes were love intrigues, 7.4%, and terrorist / extremist atrocities, 3.1%. Maharashtra has reported 60.8% murders due to class conflict. Bihar has accounted for 42.5% of murders, no prizes for guessing, due to casteism. In this analysis of the crime of murder, there is a clear causal connection between the offense and the offender. And more importantly, there is clearly discernible a structure of class and or caste and an awareness of social and class conflicts arising within those structures. I found this to be a very important acknowledgement of social and political tensions and their causal link to large-scale violence. It is also pertinent to note that in the 2004 and 2005 reports, terrorist / extremist violence accounts for 3.3 and 3.1% respectively of the total violent crimes and is relegated to incidents in certain specified areas only, whereas caste-related violence accounts for almost 27 to 33% of the crimes in certain states. Class and communal conflicts similarly account for a large percentage of the total violence. After 2004-2005, this sharp classification of offenses starts getting blurred. After 2004-2005, this sharp classification of offenses starts getting blurred until after 2014, the format itself is changed. It would seem from reading the more recent reports that terrorist violence, which earlier accounted for a very small percentage of total violent crimes, is brought center stage, while certain other structural conflicts are made completely invisible. It is a comment also on the political construction of violence, even in law. Offenses are now classified according to laws under which they are booked. Thus, murders that arise from caste or class or communal conflicts and which were earlier thus classified no longer disclose their genesis, but are shown as individual offenses listed under Section 302 IPC. Terrorist offenses are reclassified as offenses booked under the UAPA and put in the chapter on offenses against the state, together with IPC offenses like sedition, like imputation, assertions prejudicial to national integration, prevention of damage to public property act, etc. By such simple rearranging of violence, certain kinds of cases are made completely neutral, while certain other kinds of cases are made more politicized. An offense is rendered neutral because it's only reflected as offenses against the state or offenses under certain provision of the law without any further labels. Thus, lynching becomes simply a 302 offense. However, with regard to another set of offenses, the political grouping of the classification of acts suggests that there is a continuum from Mere Speech Act that impute assertions prejudicial to national integration, to sedition, to damage to public property, to terrorism. It is the same sliding scale of anti-national activities. Let me try to make myself a little more clear by giving an illustration. Someone makes a perfectly peaceful speech in good conscience, based on reason and logic and citing constitutional and legal provisions to criticize some law or some actions of the government. Some people then take out a peaceful protest march. Some others take out a march that's not so peaceful. Some public properties are damaged. As it might happen, some unlawful or terrorist organization or person also issues a statement in support of the cause. Someone else throws a bomb, killing a few people. Now, by virtue of the overbroad definition of UAPA, and by this method of grouping of offenses, all the incidents from the throwing of bomb to the making of the speech may all be treated as part of a single conspiracy, or related offenses on a sliding scale of anti-national activity, and the speaker may find himself accused of a terrorist act. In other words, the grouping of violent terrorist acts, which earlier accounted for a mere 3.3% of total violent crimes, with non-violent speech acts or petty violence, creates a new imagination of terrorism and of national security, which includes all manner of dissent and which brings the problem of terrorism center stage. To my mind, this regrouping also has an adverse effect on national security, in that by focusing more on internal dissent, the cases posing a real threat to national security and which are no more than 3% fail to get the attention they warrant. Where has this most draconian law in the world's largest democracy taken us? The results are all there for everyone to see. It stares us in the face in the death of Stan Swamy without a trial. And we must not also forget scores of Indians who get acquitted and come out of jail after 8, 10, or even 12 years with a broken life and practically no future. I submit UAPA has failed us on both counts, national security and constitutional freedoms. Before concluding, I would like to say that recently I came across a very good article by Mr. Siu Singh, senior advocate, in which he argued in favor of raising claim for compensation for the accused getting acquitted after years of incarceration. I think it's an idea that's worth following up. Thank you all. Thank you very much for a very patient hearing.
Thank you very much, Justice Alam. That was really, really useful and very enlightening. बहुत ही संक्षिप्त में हिंदी में मैं जो जस्टिस आलम ने हमें बताया उस वो बोल देती हूँ. सबसे पहले उन्होंने कहा कि यूएपीए जैसा जो कानून है, अगर उसका हम आंकलन करें, उन्होंने आंकलन करा है इस कानून का, तो ये कानून में जो प्रक्रिया है वो ही दंड है. क्योंकि जिस तरीके से लोगों को इसमें बुक किया जा रहा है और फिर लंबे अरसे तक उन्हें ना बेल होती है, उन्हें जेल में रहना पड़ता है, और जो तरीका है वो ही एक तरह से दंड बन जाता है. और उन्होंने हमारे साथ बहुत सारे आंकड़े शेयर किए, जिसको कि हम लोग इवेंचुअली प्रॉपर एक ट्रांसलेशन के थ्रू भी मुहैया कराएंगे. लेकिन उन्होंने बताया कि किस तरह से केवल 2% केसेस में कन्विक्शन होती है लोगों की. तो मतलब लोगों को इन यूएपीए के तहत जेलों में भरा जा रहा है, उनके ऊपर मुकदमे दायर हो रहे हैं, लेकिन फाइनली जाकर कितने कम लोगों को कन्विक्शन होती है वो मालूम पड़ता है कि उन्होंने वो वास्तव में अपराधी थे. और उन्होंने हमें ये भी बताया कि किस तरीके से यूएपीए का जो कानून है, यूआपा का कानून, वो किस तरह से ऐसा ऐसा करके सरकारों ने पार्लियामेंट के अंदर उसे और हार्श बनाते गए हैं, उसे और लोगों को प्रताड़ित करने वाला बनाते गए हैं. 2008 में जब मुंबई के अटैक्स हुए थे, वो हम सभी को याद है, उन्होंने बताया. उसके बाद में जो अमेंडमेंट्स हुई यूएपीए में, संशोधन आए, वो बहुत ही एक तरह से खराब संशोधन आए. और अगर हम देखें तो दूसरे जो देश हैं उनके अंदर इस तरीके के जब संशोधन लाने की कोशिश की गई कि लोगों को ज़्यादा देर तक जेल में रखा जा सकता है, ट्रायल शुरू होने से पहले रखा जा सकता है, सारी चीज़ों की, तो दूसरे देशों ने इसे बिल्कुल नकार दिया. कहा कि ये तो लोगों के मानव अधिकारों के खिलाफ है. लेकिन हमारे देश में 2008 के बाद, फिर 2012 और 2019 में फिर से इस कानून को संशोधित करके एक तरह से और भी हार्श बनाया गया है. और ये बहुत सोचने की बात है. जस्टिस आलम ने हमें ये बात कही है कि हमें सबको मिलके ये सोचना होगा कि हम किस तरीके का राज्य चाहते हैं, हम किस तरीके की स्टेट चाहते हैं, हम किसे कहते हैं कि स्ट्रॉन्ग स्टेट है। क्या स्ट्रॉन्ग स्टेट ऐसी स्टेट होती है जो कि लोगों के प्रति जवाबदेह ना हो, जो किसी को भी उठाकर जेल में लंबे अरसे तक भर दे एंटी टेरर के नाम पर, टेररिस्ट एक्ट को रोकने के नाम पर, और भी बहुत से आंकड़े जस्टिस आलम ने हमारे साथ शेयर करे, जो ऑफेंसेस हैं उनको किस तरह से साथ में जोड़ा जाता है, देखा जाता है अलग अलग ऑफेंसेस को, उनकी भी उन्होंने बात की। और उन्होंने कहा कि अगर टेररिस्ट एक्ट, जो आतंकवादी जो एक्ट हैं और जो उसके कारण जो वायलेंस है उसे देखा जाए तो मात्र 3% के करीब है, जबकि कास्ट को लेकर, कम्युनल वायलेंस को लेकर जो वायलेंस है वो 33% और उससे भी ज़्यादा कई केसेस में होती है। पर उन्होंने कहा कि एक जो बहुत ही चिंता की बात, जो आंकलन अगर हम देखें कि किस तरह से UAPA हमारे देश में लागू हो रहा है, उसमें ये चिंता की बहुत बड़ी बात है कि ग्रुपिंग किस तरीके से की जा रही है। उन्होंने बताया कि अगर कोई शांतिपूर्ण तरीके से एक भाषण दे रहे हो और एक किसी एक मुद्दे के ऊपर लोग शांतिपूर्ण तरीके से मार्च निकाल रहे हो, या फिर कुछ लोग अशांतिपूर्ण तरीके से काम कर रहे हो, कोई बॉम्ब फोड़ रहे हो, तो उन सबको इकट्ठे करके एक कॉन्स्पिरेसी में और सभी को एक तरीके से UAPA के तहत लताड़ा जा रहा है, उनके ऊपर प्रहार है। और उन्होंने कहा कि हमें इन सब चीज़ों को सोचने की ज़रूरत है, और अगर हम चाहते हैं कि जो संविधान है हमारा उसके हिसाब से लोगों के जो अधिकार हैं वो इंटैक्ट रहे, वो लोगों को हासिल हो हमारे देश में, तो इस कानून का जस्टिस आलम ने आंकलन करके हमें बताया है कि ये बहुत ही खतरनाक कानून साबित हुआ है हमारे देश में लोगों के लिए। बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद, आपका शुक्रिया जस्टिस आलम, एंड वी नाउ
थैंक यू भारद्वाज, यू इंप्रूव माय प्रेजेंटेशन,
थैंक यू वेरी मच जस्टिस आलम, एंड आई नाउ रिक्वेस्ट जस्टिस गौडा टू काइंडली स्पीक टू अस फॉर अबाउट 15 minutes. जस्टिस गौडा विल बी फोकसिंग अमंगस्ट अदर थिंग्स ऑन बैलेंसिंग द नीड फॉर एंटी टेरर लॉज फॉर नेशनल सिक्योरिटी अगेंस्ट द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनली गारंटीड राइट टू लिबर्टी एंड प्रोटेस्ट। जस्टिस गौडा, द फ्लोर इज
योर्स। थैंक यू मैडम। एट द आउटसेट I must congratulate Prashant Bhushan and Tipangi, who have organized this timely, very relevant topic on a very relevant topic. Invited the former judges of the Supreme Court and the High Court and other panelists to discuss an important topic which is being debated in the entire country and in the world over on the subject draconian laws, decent democracy. Should the UPA and sedition have a place in our statute books? Therefore, we, the law-abiding citizens, defenders of the democracy, protectors of the human rights, the people of this country, from bottom of our heart, congratulate the organizers. And I must also congratulate Anjali Bharadwaj having coordinated this program. Kofi Annan, the former Secretary General of the United Nations, once made a significant observation on the reconciliation of civil rights and liberties with national security in the context of the fight against terrorism. I quote, "We should all be clear that there is no trade-off between effective action against terrorism and protection of human rights. On the contrary, I believe that in the long term, we shall find that human rights, along with democracy and social justice, are one of the best prophylactics against terrorism, unquote. A people-centric model of national security is the quintessential need of the hour. Massive reforms are necessary in the special security legislations prevalent in India today as they reek of an authoritarian impulse, which is dangerous in a constitutional democracy. Legal reforms are imperative. The legal provisions of the special security legislations that accord impunity to state excesses need to be repealed. Stringent guidelines are to be framed for exercise of these powers. The judicial interpretations on these special laws in recent times have been erratic and situational. There is an imminent need for clarity on the overarching principles of the law in reconciliation of the conflict between human rights and the national security. The Supreme Court judgment in Watali case reported in 2019 needs to be addressed. Section 43(d)(5) of the UPA bars the grant of bail if on a perusal of the case diary and in the opinion of the court, there are reasonable grounds for believing that the accusation against such person is prima facie true. Therefore, the UPA restricts the role of courts to examine the case of prosecution while considering grant of bail and precludes bail in the prosecution's version without being subject to the rigor of cross-examination or challenge appears true on the face of it. In Watali, the Supreme Court further held that it was not permissible for the court to even engage in a detailed analysis of the prosecution case while considering bail under the UPA to weigh whether the evidence adduced by the prosecution was even sufficient or not effectively. While the statute itself limited the role of courts to have one-sided view only of the case of the prosecution in its determination of the question of bail, the Watali judgment tied both hands of the defense by effectively prohibiting any substantial challenge to the case of the prosecution. The grant of bail is rendered almost impossible until the end of the trial, which could take generations. A wholly unconstitutional interpretation of the UPA that strikes at the root of the fundamental right to life. Personal liberties and speedy trial guaranteed under the Constitution. Fortunately, there are several judgments that have attempted to harmonize the human rights and national security. The Honorable Supreme Court of India, in the case of Union of India versus K.A. Najib, judgment dated 1st February 2021, Chief Justice N.V. Ramana, the Justice Surya Kant and Justice Anirudh Bose have held, I quote, the presence of statutory restrictions like Section 43(d)(5) of the UPA per se does not boost the ability of constitutional courts to grant bail on grounds of violation of Part 3 of the Constitution. Indeed, both the restrictions under the statute as well as the powers exercisable under the constitutional jurisdiction can be well harmonized. Whereas at commencement of the proceedings, courts are expected to appreciate the legislative policy against the grant of bail, but the rigors of such provision will melt down where there is no likelihood of trial being completed within a reasonable time. The records of the cases against whom the cases are pending, it varies. 12 years in Ahmedabad case, the trial was concluded thousands of people were acquitted under the Terrorist Act in the year 1985 Act. Such an approach would safeguard against the possibility of provisions like Section 43D5 of UPA being used as the sole metric for denial of bail or for wholesale breach of constitutional right to speedy trial. Speedy trial, Supreme Court, right from 1979, has been repeatedly laying down the law that speedy trial is the part of the life includes livelihood. This is being blatantly violated even in respect of the cases filed against the accused persons under the UPA and the sedition law. Unquote. In the above judgment, the apex court also refers to the orders enlarging similarly situated accused under the UPA passed earlier by the apex court in Angela Harish Sontakke versus State of Maharashtra, 2016 Supreme Court. That was also a case under sections 10, 13, 17, 18, 18A, 18B, 20, 21, 38, 39, and 40, subsection 2 of the UPA Act. This court, in its earnest effort to draw balance between the seriousness of the charges with the period of custody suffered and likely period within which the trial could be expected to be completed, took note of 5 years incarceration and over 200 witnesses left to be examined, and thus granted bail to the accused, notwithstanding Section 43D5 of UPA. Similarly, in Sagar Tataram Gorkhe versus State of Maharashtra, reported in 2017, an accused under UPA was enlarged for he had been in jail for 4 years, and there were over 147 witnesses unexamined. This is very relevant. The exceptionally stringent provisions of UPA, which render the granting of bail extremely difficult, are meant to apply only to exceptional cases that fall within the narrow ambit of the legislative intent behind special laws like UPA. They are not intended to replace ordinary penal law. This quintessential distinction between the state of exception and the state of normalcy has been compromised by laws such as the UPA, whose ambiguous and broad provision allow state instrumentalities to invoke and apply them indiscriminately, and thus keep people behind bars for years without trial. Unfortunately, it has now become a weapon against dissent to take in several democratic dissenters as prisoners of conscience. A sacrosanct principle of interpretation of penal provisions is that they must be construed strictly and narrowly in order to ensure that a person who was not within the legislative intendment does not get roped into a penal provision. It follows as a corollary that the stringency of provision warrants an equally stringent construction. Some principles that could inform a jurisprudence that accords due deference to civil rights even within the restrictive confines of the UPA can be culled out from certain judgments already delivered on the point by several high courts and the apex court. Number one, the operation of special security legislations like UPA, designed to deal with specific exceptional circumstances, must be restricted to such cases, and their operation should not be blurred with ordinary legislation. Two, criminal statutes must always be narrowly construed and their terms given due specificity. Three, the word terrorism in the UPA must be given specific meaning that relates to the defense of India as a sovereign nation, which must be distinguished from public order offenses. Public order issue must not be colored with seditious motives. In order to establish prima facie case of terrorism and Rupa again an accused. The allegation must be individualized, factual, and particularistic. Needless to say, there must be no scope or speculation in the objective determination of actual facts. Speculation or inference should not inform the determination of a prima facie case under the UPA and discharge the prosecution's prima facie burden under Section 43(d)(5). If the actual facts devoid of speculation render such burden undischarged, normal principles of speculation, normal principles bail under general and penal procedure should apply. Yet another grave issue with special security legislation like the UPA, APSAPA, etc., that lay down standards for permissible departure, derogation of civil rights and liberties is the lack of accountability and sometimes de facto or worse de jure impunity to agencies of the state for any and every action taken in discharge of their duties under such laws. While general penal law requires prior sanction to prosecute a public servant for an alleged offense committed by him or her when purporting to act in discharge of their public duties, some special security legislations like the UPA grants blanket protection by imposing complete bar on prosecution in such cases, Section 49 of the UPA Act. The consequences of vesting such unbridled power without any accountability in the state instrumentalities is dangerous for a constitutional democracy, as it sets the stage for enabling excesses by the state with impunity. With great power comes great responsibility. It is high time that the state is vested with that quintessential responsibility to harmonize civil and national security by appreciating the fact that neither is subject to a trade-off under any circumstance is a constitutional democracy. This is my view on this, the aspect of the topic which is assigned to me. I am of the view that the courts, merely because there is a restriction, I don't think that provision cannot take away the constitutional power of the constitutional courts. The constitutional courts have got basic power, that is the judicial review power as held by Supreme Court in a 9-judge bench case and which has been subsequently followed in Bommai's case. That is basic, judicial review is the basic structure of the Constitution. And the human rights are being violated, indiscriminately filing cases against the persons who have expressed their dissent shall not be allowed to languish in the jails. More particularly, Stan Swamy was hailing very salient, both the state, NIA, and the courts have failed to take into consideration that he was entitled for bail on the medical grounds on such stringent terms and conditions. That has not been done. That has made him to die in the hospital. This aspect is very alarming, and the all right-thinking people, but more particularly the judges of the Indian courts, district judiciary, the constitutional courts, must take note of this important aspect of the matter, interpret the provisions, and does not say that we have no power to deal with this kind of cases where the vengefully the cases for having expressed their dissent and filed the cases made them to languish in the jails. These are my views. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you very much, Justice Gowda. That was very, very interesting and very comprehensive. And I will try to very briefly translate that into Hindi as well for those who prefer to understand it in Hindi. जस्टिस गौडा ने बहुत ज़रूरी बातें अभी रखी. उन्होंने बात शुरू करी कोफी अनान जी से के बाद से उन्होंने कहा कि ये जो बार बार बात होती है कि एक तरफ पे टेररिज्म आतंकवाद और दूसरी तरफ पे लोगों के जो मानव अधिकार हैं, तो मतलब इन्हें ऐसे देखा जाता है कि जैसे ये बड़ी कंपीटिंग कुछ चीज़ें हैं जिन्हें बैलेंस करने की ज़रूरत है। पर उन्होंने कहा कि अगर लोगों के मानव अधिकारों का वास्तव में प्रोटेक्ट किया जाएगा तो टेररिज्म खुद ब खुद भी कम होती है। तो उनका ये मानना है कि सब कोफी अनान जी ने जैसे कहा था कि सबसे बढ़िया तरीका टेररिज्म को भी आतंकवाद को भी कम करने का यही है कि लोगों के मानव अधिकारों का सही से पालन हो किसी भी देश में। वटाली जजमेंट का आपने विवरण किया जिसमें कि जो मुद्दा है सबसे बड़ा आज यूएपीए के जो सारे केसेस आ रहे हैं उसमें बेल नहीं मिलती है लोगों को, तो उसमें वटाली जजमेंट का जो पूरा एक भूमिका है उसके बारे में आपने बात करी कि किस तरीके से अब ट्रायल तो बहुत समय तक चल सकता है लेकिन लोगों को बेल मिलना जिनके खिलाफ यूएपीए के तहत मुकदमे जारी हैं वो किस तरह से लगभग असंभव हो जाता है और उसको फिर से देखने की ज़रूरत है। आपने ये कहा, आपने कहा कि व्यक्तिगत स्वतंत्रता और जल्द से जल्द सुनवाई हो और कोर्ट फैसलों पर पहुंचे, ये हमारे देश में संवैधानिक अधिकार है हमारा। और आपने कहा कि दुख की बात है कि यूएपीए और देशद्रोह सेडिशन जैसे कानूनों के तहत सरकारें जो हैं सालों साल दशकों लगा देती हैं और लोग जेलों में रह जाते हैं। आपने बताया किस तरह से अहमदाबाद में 12 साल के बाद हजारों लोगों का अक्विटल हुआ था और आपने ये भी कहा कि इस तरीके की चीज़ों के ऊपर कई सुप्रीम कोर्ट की भी ऑब्जर्वेशंस है कि ये बिल्कुल गलत है और इस तरीके से नहीं होना चाहिए। यूएपीए को आपने कहा कि सरकारें हथियार बनाकर उनका इस्तेमाल कर रही हैं ऐसे लोगों के खिलाफ जो अपनी आवाज़ उठाते हैं अगर कहीं पर वो कुछ गलत होता देखे तो ये आपने कहा कि बिल्कुल ही किसी भी संवैधानिक और दृष्टिकोण से और किसी भी लोकतंत्र में ये सही नहीं माना जा सकता है। आपने कुछ मुख्य बिंदुओं की भी चर्चा की। आपने कहा कि यूएपीए जैसे कानूनों का सेडिशन जैसे कानूनों का जो उपयोग है वो ऐसे ही किसी एक ब्रॉड तरीके से नहीं किया जाना चाहिए है। जब किसी चीज़ को टेररिज्म का करार दिया जाए आतंकवाद का करार दिया जाए उसका एक बहुत स्पेसिफिक मायना होता है। जो पब्लिक ऑर्डर के केसेस हैं उसमें जो एलिगेशंस हैं उसके अंदर ब्लर नहीं होनी चाहिए बाउंड्रीज, वो अलग रहने की बहुत ज़रूरत है। और आपने ये भी याद दिलाया सरकारों को कि जब हमारे पास ज़्यादा ताकत होती है तो जिम्मेदारी भी बढ़ती है। तो अंग्रेजी में विद ग्रेट पावर कम्स ग्रेट रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी। तो जो इम्प्यूनिटी है सरकारों की, जो पुलिस की इम्प्यूनिटी है जिसके साथ वो लोगों को बिना किसी डर के सालों साल ऐसे केसेस के अंदर बंद रखते हैं, उस पर जवाबदेही बहुत ज़रूरी है। तो आपका आपने ये पॉइंट को बहुत स्ट्रॉन्गली मेक किया है और आपने ये कहा है कि कोर्ट्स को जुडिशियल रिव्यू का जो कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन में संविधान में जो पावर्स हैं उसके इस्तेमाल की यहाँ पर सख्त ज़रूरत भी है। और आपने अंत में फादर स्टैन स्वामी की हमें जो जिस तरीके से उनकी मौत हुई उसके बारे में आपने बात रखी कि शायद पूरी की पूरी हमारी जुडिशरी को हमारे देश में हम सभी को भी ये सोचने की ज़रूरत है कि इस तरीके की चीज़ आज कैसे हो रही है और किस तरह से फादर स्टैन स्वामी इतने समय तक वो बीमार भी रहे लेकिन उन्हें मेडिकल बेल ठीक से नहीं मिली, उन्हें मेडिकल बेल नहीं मिली और उनकी किस तरह से डेथ हुई, उनकी किस तरह से मौत हुई, ये बहुत ही शर्मनाक भी चीज़ है। तो बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद जस्टिस गौड़ा आपका आपने थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर फॉर दिस वेरी इनलाइटनिंग
नजीब जजमेंट यू डिड नॉट हैव नजीब जजमेंट वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट जजमेंट नजीब यूनियन ऑफ इंडिया वर्सेस नजीब 2008 एनवी रमणा जस्टिस सिरी रमणा चीफ जस्टिस सॉरी कॉल दे हैव सेड
जी नजीब
43D5
जी आपने नजीब जजमेंट की भी जिक्र किया था जिसमें 43D5 के ऊपर रोशनी डली थी और उसमें ये कहा गया था कि इतने लंबे समय तक किसी को बिना आप बिना कारण के बिना पुख्ता सबूत के बंद नहीं रख सकते तीन जजेस की बेंच की ये जजमेंट थी जो सुप्रीम कोर्ट से आई थी तो ऐसी बहुत सी और भी जजमेंट्स थी जिसके बारे में आपने जिक्र किया जस्टिस गौड़ा हम इन सभी को एक डिटेल्ड ट्रांसलेशन में भी वी विल पुट द ट्रांसलेशन ट्रांसलेशंस आउट एज वेल सब्सिक्वेंटली ड्यू टू शॉर्टेज ऑफ टाइम आई एम रियली सॉरी वी आर नॉट एबल टू कवर ऑल द इम्पॉर्टेंट पॉइंट्स दैट हैव बीन मेड बट थैंक यू एवर सो मच एंड आई नाउ रिक्वेस्ट जस्टिस गुप्ता to please speak to us on this issue. Justice Gupta will be talking about the legislative intent of UAPA and sedition and the ground reality of the use of these laws, especially it's their use against journalists, human rights workers, and other dissenters, including some of the recent, very well publicized cases as well. So, Justice Deepak Gupta, may I please request you to speak for the next 15 minutes to all of us. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Anjali. I'm very grateful to the organizers for having given me the opportunity of presenting my views on this subject. Now, coming to the main topic, democracy, dissent, and draconian laws. In a democracy, dissent is essential, and draconian laws have no place. I think you don't need to have a webinar on that. It's a given. But in what has happened in the recent past, in the last few years, the way laws have been misused, not used, but laws have been misused to stifle dissent, to quell the, you know, voices which ask explanations from the government, which is the right of any citizen in a democracy. It is that which is really worrying me a lot and what I would like to speak on. The earlier speaker, Justice Alam, made a superb analysis of the UAPA, the various cases being filed under it and all the statistical details he gave. Justice Gopala Gowda, as usual, spoke with great, I mean, he's an orator, not unlike me, and he spoke so well on and gave a good analysis of the various judgments. Sedition has not been touched, so I'd like to first, on the 2 to 3 minutes, I'd like to speak on sedition first. I think sedition, the law of sedition, is an anathema in a democracy, where every citizen has a right to question the government. In fact, if you know, when you know, it was introduced by a colonial power. And the intention was very clear that no native in their terms, or the person belonging, and no Indian should raise his voice against the British Raj. That was what the act was meant. And, you know, when they had brought in this act, they had said that anything which brings about hatred or contempt or excites disaffection or enmity against the state, etc., would be sedition. All I can use is what Mahatma Gandhi had said, that affection cannot be manufactured by law. If one has no affection for a person or system, one should be free to give the fullest expression to his disaffection, so long as he does not contemplate, promote, or incite to violence. But unfortunately, almost till a couple of years till before independence, the view taken was that this sedition, anything you say which is amounts to disaffection or contempt of the government would be sedition. Sir Maurice Guyer, who was also Vice Chancellor of the Delhi University later, you see that was the important position which Vice Chancellors were held. After being Chief Justice of India, he went back to becoming Vice Chancellor of the Delhi University. He held otherwise. He said, unless there's incitement to violence, it can't be sedition. Unfortunately, judgment was overturned by the Privy Council. I'm not giving details because of shortage of time. And finally, the Supreme Court in 1962, a five-judge bench, gave a clear definition of what would amount to sedition. Sedition would only be if there is an incitement to violence or grave public disorder. Otherwise, your act will not just saying, taking part in the farmers' protest like Disha Ravi did, does not amount to sedition. See, this misuse of the law of sedition itself creates a problem because it is an attempt to stifle the voices of those who question the powers that be, which in a democracy is the very essence of democracy, that I may not agree with you, you may not agree with me, but we should politely agree to disagree with each other. How can you have a democratic debate? Even today, I wish it was not like an echo chamber, frankly. I wish we could have had some voices which had the other side to say also. Because sometimes you're just parroting what each one of us has said. So despite this law being so clear, it has again been misused. And now Justice U.U. Lalit recently in another judgment, in the Vinod Dua judgment, has again clarified what is sedition. But my view is these clarifications may come and go, but the police will keep misusing if they can have, after the Supreme Court declares Section 66A of the IT Act to be Information Technology Act to be illegal in the Shreya Singhal case, unconstitutional, as being, violative of the right of free speech, and still hundreds and thousands of cases were filed even if it was declared unconstitutional. I think the time has come, and the oral remarks made by the Honorable Chief Justice do give us some hope that maybe when this case is argued this time, maybe sedition would be held to be the law of sedition as frame 124A would be unconstitutional. In my view, it, you know, the only reason why it was held to be constitution was by putting it in that straitjacket of only incitement to violence, etc. Today you have so many laws, other laws, dealing with incitement to violence, including the other law which we are discussing today, UAPA. So my personal view is that as far as the law of sedition is concerned, there is no case whatsoever for retaining it in the statute book. This law should be shown the door as soon as possible. And but if, like any democracy, the court has another view, I still feel that certain things should be done. In 74, Mrs. Gandhi made this law, this offense, a cognizable offense. It should be again brought back to the pre-74 stage. During pre-independence, it was a non-cognizable offense in 74. So you have made it harsher and harsher over a period of time. So you don't, now the policeman doesn't even require a warrant from the court to arrest somebody, and somebody sitting in a remote village of Himachal files a case against a journalist from Delhi and gets him charged for sedition. So there has to be some safeguards, though I would be much more happier if the law itself is repealed or held to be unconstitutional. Coming to UAPA, I think the discussion on UAPA is very necessary, but with a caveat. I am not saying that we do not require a law to deal with terrorist activities. We may be requiring a law to deal with terrorist activities, but it should be with well-defined terrorist activities, not a nebulous, vague definition of terrorism as is done in the UAPA. What that has led to, and as pointed out by Justice Gopala Gowda, is the incarceration of people for years on end, knowing fully well, the police also knows fully well that no case is made out, but they add UAPA and the courts are reluctant to grant bail or they feel that they can't grant bail. I'll come to that aspect later. But what is worrying is what has happened recently when Mohammed Ilyas and Irfan were acquitted by the NIA court and everybody was released after 12 years. 122 persons in Surat released after 20 years of being charged under the UUP. Natasha Narwal did get bail, but her father died during this period. Similarly, Siddiq Kappan's mother died while he was in jail. Father Stan Swamy, 84 years old, suffering from Parkinson's disease. I mean, are we not humans? Have we lost all touch of humanity that this man requires bail? Even if there is a 43D or a 43E, there is something which is more, where the powers of the Superior Court must be used to grant bail to these people. So that he, no doubt the Bombay High Court did ensure that he got proper treatment in jail. But why could he not? He was not going to leave the country. What is the purpose of bail? The purpose of bail is that the person should not influence the witnesses, that he should not run away from justice, that he should be available for investigation. And the court had adequate powers to put such restrictions if bail was granted to Father Stan Swamy or others like him. But what comes in the way is 48-4 and that judgment, 48-D, sorry, 44-D and the judgment in Vatali's case. Thankfully, in Najib's case, the three-judge bench has now taken a broader view and has said that the powers of the superior courts cannot be vetoed even by a provision like that. But I'm not so sure whether that whether that still leaves it in a nebulous situation on a judge-to-judge basis. In my opinion, a provision which effectually takes away the power of the superior courts to grant bail, denies the power of judicial review to the accused person, and is therefore unconstitutional. You can lay down conditions like they have been laid down in the NDPS Act, etc. But here the condition is that you have to believe what everything is which has been said in the report under 173. And then whatever the policeman has said in the 173 report, if you believe it to be true, then there is going to be no bail. Let's face it. Any police officer worth his salt will ensure that his 173 report will prima facie appear to be true. The Delhi High Court Justice Bambani's judgment is remarkable in that sense. It's really remarkable. Because they've said that no case under UAPA is made up. See, they didn't have to go into the 43D because according to them, no case under the UAPA was made out because there is no terrorist activity. They were organizing some chakka jams, they were organizing some protests, they were against the CAA. So where is the question of applying UAPA? Having said that, I am of the opinion that a law like the UAPA should not remain on the statute book in the form it is. If you need an anti-terror law, in fact, Kofi Annan was cited. I could cite Lal Bahadur Shastri, who said that if I have to deal with the problems in Nagaland and Manipur, I don't need an act like this to deal with these problems. I can deal it on a face-to-face basis by talking to them. But we cannot totally shut our eyes to the fact that terrorism is a worry in today's world. And terrorism from international levels is also a worry. When something like the Bombay attacks happen, it is worrying for all of us. And therefore, an act, I will not go to the extent that no law is required against terrorism. But then that law must be very strictly interpreted. It should be it should be used only against terrorist activities. It should be drafted in such a manner and interpreted by the courts in such a manner that there is no scope for misuse. Till now, the courts have always taken a view when there is a challenge to the constitutionality of the law, like the UAPA, that, well, if there is scope of misuse, we can't set aside the law. We can only, when there is misuse, check it. I think a time has come to relook this proposition of law also. If a law is capable of gross abuse, and it is proven to the court that it is being abused day in and day out. I mean, look at the NSA. A gentleman in Manipur says, cow urine will not cure COVID. So slam him inside behind bars and put him for NSA. I mean, are we living in a police state? We have to think about these things. And I think the courts also have to relook at a lot of the earlier judgments and see that if there is a challenge to the law, if it is capable of gross abuse, then even if the law does not provide, then the court, invoking its inherent powers under 142, like it did in Vishakha's case, like it did in other cases, can lay down guidelines that these will be the guidelines before you will initiate a case under UAP. You know, the guidelines, some guidelines are there. There's a review committee. But we all know what the review committee does. It reads 2,800 pages overnight and sanctions the and approves the prosecution the next day. Therefore, the time has come when there has to be payment of compensation in lieu of incarceration, which is held to be illegal later. And this compensation should be paid. I mean, like in this gentleman from Manipur, the DM must be fastened with paying the compensation to him. It should be a very handsome amount, and he should be fastened to pay the compensation out of his own pocket. So that he next time, when his political masters ask him to put a man behind bars who's got bail, he will think twice. The courts also have to be much more stricter. Stricter with the law enforcement agencies, not with the people who are victims of these laws. Up till now, there has been this tendency in this jingoism of nationalism, etc., that UAP has been applied. They must be involved in an anti-national activity. You know, the courts at these district level do get a bit, you know, they get worried whether if they grant bail, what will be the public, you know, in this world where social media is important, they worry about that. So I think it's for the high courts and the Supreme Court to lead from the front, because the superior courts have two roles in my opinion. One is the adjudicatory role of deciding cases. The other is the very important role of being the protector and defender of human rights of the citizens. The Indian Constitution is one of the few constitutions in the world which has an article like Article 32, where even the right to approach the highest court of the land for enforcement of the fundamental rights is itself a fundamental right. That is the importance which our founding fathers gave to the fundamental rights. And the court, when it is charged with their duty, is also charged with the duty and the responsibility to be a protector and defender of the human rights of the people. And therefore, when you look at that and you combine these roles together, it will become much easier to come to a resolution that laws which are very vague either should be struck down, or the vagueness should be removed by the courts by saying that this is, if these things you do, then the law will be valid, otherwise it will not be. See, the wide, I'm not going to go into a very deep analysis because that has already been done. But, and I'm sure Justice Anjana Prakash is going to dwell, I've read her articles on UAPA, so she'll be dealing on that, so I'm not going to cover that. The vagueness in the laws, both in sedition and the UAPA, is what helps the prosecuting agency in charging people and putting them behind bars. I'm sorry to say this, having been in the profession for 40 odd years, that some of our judges still don't realize what is sedition, what is terrorism, and I'm so happy that the Delhi High Court did come out with this judgment. And it's a very well-written judgment. I've read it more than once, and I feel that this could be one of the best analyses of the way to approach bail in UAP cases. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Justice Gupta. And you have been, like many other, all the other panelists today, a very, very strong voice for dissent and democracy in our country. And what you said today was very, very important, significant, and I'm going to try and very briefly translate it. There were so many points that I'm sure that I will not do it justice, but I will try very briefly.
Pleasure. Just do a small thing for them.
जी, तो जस्टिस गुप्ता ने बात शुरू यहीं से करी कि मतलब विरोधाभास के बगैर तो लोकतंत्र हो ही नहीं सकता, और जिस तरीके के कानून युआपा और देशद्रोह हैं वो तो होने ही शायद नहीं चाहिए हैं डेमोक्रेसी में, लोकतंत्र में. तो उन्होंने कहा कि इसके ऊपर डिस्कशन की भी ज़रूरत नहीं होनी चाहिए, लेकिन आज हम लोग ये डिस्कशन कर रहे हैं और ये डिस्कशन ज़रूरी है. उसके पीछे कारण ये है कि देशद्रोह का और यूएपीए का जो कानून है उसे किस तरीके से इस्तेमाल किया जा रहा है, बल्कि उन्होंने कहा यूज नहीं, मिसयूज किया जा रहा है इन कानूनों का, आज हम देख रहे हैं हमारे देश में. और जो भी आवाज़ उठा रहे हैं उनके ऊपर दबाव बनाने के लिए, उन्हें प्रताड़ित करने के लिए इन कानूनों का इस्तेमाल हो रहा है, इसलिए बहुत ज़रूरी आज की जो डिस्कशन है वो हो जाती है. उन्होंने सिडिशन के कानून पर रोशनी डाली ज़्यादा डिटेल में. उन्होंने कहा कि देशद्रोह जैसा जो कानून है वो तो मतलब डेमोक्रेसी में हम कह सकते हैं कि उसका पूरी तरह से विरोधाभास है, जो डेमोक्रेसी, जो लोकतंत्र की जो स्पिरिट है उससे. ये एक अंग्रेज़ों के ज़माने का कानून है और वो ब्रिटिश राज में लाया गया, ये उसकी वर्डिंग से ही समझ में आता है कि अगर किसी को डिसअफेक्शन होती है स्टेट से, कुछ ऐसी बातें कहते हैं लोग जिससे कि जो सरकार है उसके खिलाफ लोग सोचें, उसके उससे स्नेह ना हो, तो उन्होंने कहा कि उसके अंदर, देशद्रोह के अंदर, इस कानून के अंदर 124A जो है उसके तहत वो एक ऑफेंस हो जाता है. लेकिन उन्होंने गांधी जी की बात कही कि जो अफेक्शन है, जो एक दूसरे के प्रति स्नेह है या किसी के प्रति स्नेह है, वो ज़बरदस्ती से नहीं हो सकता है. और अगर लोगों को कोई तकलीफ है सरकार से, अगर वो दुखी हैं तो वो कहेंगे, और उन्हें बोलने का अधिकार है, अपनी बात व्यक्त करने का अधिकार है लोकतंत्र में. इस पर उन्होंने केदारनाथ की जो जजमेंट थी उसके बारे में कहा कि ऐसा नहीं है कि स्वतंत्र भारत में कोर्ट्स ने इस कानून को या इस देशद्रोह के जो 124A है उसको कोशिश नहीं की है उसको कहने की कि ऐसे ही इस्तेमाल नहीं हो सकता. केवल अगर कोई ये इंसाइट करते हैं, वायलेंस को इंसाइट करते हैं, हिंसा को इंसाइट करते हैं, या पब्लिक डिसऑर्डर को इंसाइट करते हैं अपनी बातों से, केवल तभी ये लागू हो सकता है, लेकिन उन्होंने कहा कि किस तरीके से इसका इस्तेमाल हो रहा है, जो किसानों का प्रोटेस्ट चल रहा है, फार्मर्स प्रोटेस्ट चल रहे हैं, दिशा रवि का केस है, ऐसे तमाम केसेस के बारे में जस्टिस दीपक गुप्ता ने कहा कि देशद्रोह लगाया जा रहा है, जो कि मतलब कल्पना भी नहीं की जा सकती कि कैसे ये केसेस के अंदर देशद्रोह लगाया जा सकता है। उन्होंने जस्टिस यूयू ललित का जो जजमेंट रिसेंटली आया है, एक पत्रकार जो है विनोद दुआ उनके केस में, उसका भी जिक्र किया, और श्रेया सिंगल का जो 67A जो आईटी का कानून है उसके जो कॉन्टेक्स्ट में जजमेंट आया है, कहा है कि वो 66A वायलेटिव है हमारे संवैधानिक अधिकार का, बोलने के अधिकार का जो जो है हमें उसके खिलाफ जाता है, उसका भी उन्होंने जिक्र किया। उन्होंने कहा कि जो अभी मौजूदा चीफ जस्टिस हैं इंडिया के, उन्होंने जो बोलने में बात रखी है, मतलब ओरल ऑब्जर्वेशंस की हैं, वो कुछ उम्मीद देती हैं, और उम्मीद है कि आगे जाते हुए जो 124A के खिलाफ और सेडिशन के, देशद्रोह के खिलाफ जो केसेस डल रहे हैं कोर्ट में, जब उनकी सुनवाई होगी तो हम उम्मीद करते हैं कि उन पर सही से सुनवाई होगी। और उन्होंने कहा कि ऑलरेडी ऐसे कानून हैं जो कि अगर हिंसा को कुछ भड़काता है, कोई ऐसी बातें करता है, उससे डील करते हैं, तो इसलिए उनका मानना है कि जो सेडिशन का, देशद्रोह का कानून है, उस कानून का कोई मतलब नहीं है हमारे लोकतंत्र में आज की तारीख में। उन्होंने ये भी कहा कि यूएपीए का जो कानून है, यूआपा का जो कानून है, वो ये नहीं मानते कि आतंकवाद से डील करने के लिए हमें कानून नहीं चाहिए, तो उनका मानना है कि होने चाहिए कानून जो कि आतंकवाद से डील करें, लेकिन उनको जब प्रयोग किया जाए तो बहुत ध्यान से प्रयोग होना चाहिए, और कानून जो लिखा गया है वो ऐसा नहीं होना चाहिए कि वो गलत तरीके से प्रयोग हो सके। और उन्होंने बताया कि किस तरीके से मोहम्मद इलायस और जैसे लोगों को 10 साल तक सूरत में, 20 साल तक लोगों को जेल में रखा गया, नताशा नरवाल जो कि एक स्टूडेंट है दिल्ली यूनिवर्सिटी में, दिल्ली में, उन्हें किस तरीके से दिल्ली रायट्स के केस में जेल में रखा गया, उनके पिता की मृत्यु हो गई, वो मिल भी नहीं पाई उनसे। सिद्दीकी कप्पान को जेल में रखा जा रहा है, वो उनकी मदर की डेथ हो गई, उनकी माँ की मृत्यु हो गई। फादर स्टैन स्वामी 84 साल के, उन्हें पार्किंसन डिजीज थी, उन्हें बेल नहीं मिली, तो उन्होंने कहा कि क्या हमने अपनी मानवता खो दी है, क्या ये नहीं देखा जा सकता कि जेल में क्यों रखा जाए, बेल क्यों ना दी जाए, इन सब चीज़ों को सही से एग्जामिन नहीं होना चाहिए है। अगर लगता है कि कोई भाग जाएंगे, कोई इन्वेस्टिगेशन को सही से नहीं चलने देंगे, या फिर कोई इन्फ्लुएंस करने की कोशिश करेंगे इन्वेस्टिगेशन को, तभी उन्हें बेल नहीं दी जानी चाहिए, वरना फादर स्टैन स्वामी जैसे लोगों को ना बेल देने का कोई मतलब ही नहीं होता। उन्होंने नजीब केस की फिर से बात करी, जो जस्टिस गाउडा ने भी जिस केस के बारे में जिक्र किया था कि ये एक अच्छा, उसके अंदर बातें हुई हैं, कुछ जजमेंट आई है अच्छी, कि यूएपीए जैसे कानून जो हमारी उच्च न्यायालय हैं उनके हाथ नहीं बांध सकते, लेकिन फिर भी उन्होंने कहा प्रॉब्लम है और जो समस्या है वो परसिस्ट करती है, और उन्होंने कहा कि हमें सोचना पड़ेगा कि क्या हम कहीं पुलिस राज तो नहीं बनते जा रहे, और अगर हम अपने आप को वास्तव में लोकतंत्र कहते हैं तो बटाली जजमेंट और जो ये सारी जो 43D जो है यूएपीए का, इन सब की कोई जगह नहीं है इस तरीके से जो लिखी गई हैं उनकी हमारे लोकतंत्र में। और उन्होंने ये कहा कि अभी तो ये हो रहा है कि पुलिस वाला केवल कह दे कि यूएपीए है, देशद्रोह है, तो लोगों को सालों साल बेल नहीं मिलेगी, उन्हें जेल में रहना पड़ेगा। उन्होंने लाल बहादुर शास्त्री बातों की याद दिलाई कि उन्होंने कहा था कि वैसे तो टेरर लॉ की भी जरूरत नहीं है, लोगों से बातचीत करके भी मसला सुलझाया जा सकता है, लेकिन फिर भी उन्होंने कहा कि आतंकवाद समस्या है, हमें कानून अच्छा चाहिए, लेकिन कानून बहुत ही सही तरीके से वर्डेड होना चाहिए है, वो बिल्कुल खुला तरीके से ऐसा नहीं होना चाहिए कि उसकी इंटरप्रिटेशन हो सके, और उसकी ड्राफ्टिंग, उसको किस तरह से लिखा गया है वो बहुत ज़रूरी है। और उन्होंने कहा कि कहीं पर ये हमारी जुडिशरी को सोचने की ज़रूरत है कि जब जुडिशरी कहती है कि अगर कानून बना हुआ है हम उस कानून को नहीं हटा सकते, हम उसको सेट असाइड नहीं कर सकते, लेकिन अगर उसका दुरुपयोग हो तब हम उसे रोक सकते हैं, तो हर समय क्या ये कहना सही रहेगा और हर परिप्रेक्ष्य में क्या ये कहना सही रहेगा? क्योंकि अगर बार बार दिख रहा है कि कोई कानून उसका दुरुपयोग हो रहा है और लगातार होने की संभावना भी है, तो कोर्ट्स को कुछ ना कुछ तो करना ही होगा। और उन्होंने ये भी कहा कि कहीं पर कुछ गाइडलाइंस ले डाउन करने की शायद बहुत सख्त ज़रूरत है, जिससे कि इतनी आसानी से पुलिस और सरकारें कानूनों का दुरुपयोग ना कर सके। मतलब उन्होंने जो अभी रिसेंटली मणिपुर में नेशनल सिक्योरिटी एक्ट का जो कानून का इस्तेमाल हुआ, जिसमें एक पत्रकार ने कह दिया कि गौमूत्र कोविड का को सही नहीं कर सकता, तो इसलिए उनको केवल डाल दिया गया, एनएसए के तहत पकड़ लिया गया। उन्होंने कहा कि इस तरीके की चीज़ें कैसे देखी जा सकती हैं और कैसे सही जा सकती हैं, और उन्होंने कोर्ट्स को इसलिए कहा कि ये देखने की, कोर्ट्स को भी शायद ये सोचने की ज़रूरत है, रिफ्लेक्ट करने की ज़रूरत है कि वो क्या करें, और शायद मुआवजे का भी समय आ गया है, मुआवजा देने का ऐसे लोगों को जिनको कि गलत समय तक सालों साल बंद किया जाता है, उनकी ज़िंदगी बेकार हो जाती है, पूरी बीत जाती है जेल की सलाखों के पीछे, क्या उन्हें मुआवजा नहीं देना चाहिए है? और शायद स्पेसिफिक ऑफिसर्स को वो मुआवजा देने पर मजबूर किया जाएगा, तभी ये गलत तरीका जो है वो इस्तेमाल होने का बंद होगा। और राष्ट्रवाद के नाम पर ये जो काम हो रहे हैं, और कहीं शायद जजेस भी घबरा जाते हैं कि हम अगर किसी को छोड़ देंगे, बेल दे देंगे, तो लोग क्या कहेंगे, क्योंकि राष्ट्रवाद के जो जज्बा है उसमें बहकर लोग कहीं ना कहें कि ये आपने क्यों करा। तो इससे, इस प्रेशर से भी जुडिशरी को अपने आप को आज़ाद करने की ज़रूरत है। और आर्टिकल 32 जो हमारे देश के संविधान ने हमें दिया है वो बहुत ही सिग्निफिकेंट है, क्योंकि वो फंडामेंटल राइट है कि अगर मेरी मौलिक अधिकार का हनन हो तो मेरे पास मौलिक अधिकार है कि मैं कोर्ट के पास जा सकूं और मेरा मौलिक अधिकार की सुरक्षा हो। तो ऐसे संविधान के होते हुए, ऐसे प्रावधान के होते हुए बहुत ज़रूरी है कि लोगों के जो मौलिक अधिकार हैं उनका हनन ना हो। थैंक यू वेरी मच जस्टिस गुप्ता, आपका बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया। एंड आई विल नाउ रिक्वेस्ट जस्टिस अंजना प्रकाश टू प्लीज स्पीक टू अस फॉर 15 मिनट्स। जस्टिस प्रकाश इज गोइंग टू स्पीक स्पेसिफिकली ऑन इज इट टाइम फॉर द गवर्नमेंट टू रिडीम इटसेल्फ एंड रिपील द यूएपीए लॉ। सो जस्टिस प्रकाश, आई रिक्वेस्ट यू टू अनम्यूट योरसेल्फ प्लीज, and the floor is yours.
Thank you, Anjali, and with apologies to Justice Modan Lokur that I'm going before him. Actually, I have a family commitment, and therefore, sir, I beg your permission for this, sir. The topic all of us know is whether UAPA and sedition laws have a place in our statute books. Justice Deepak Gupta rightly pointed out that it in the present form as it is not acceptable. And I would also agree with him when he says that it is, why is it not permissible? I would say because it is vague. The definition in paragraph in section 15 is so vague that it is susceptible to misuse. And therefore, what now has happened is that instead of thinking that it is to be used, you know, for sovereignty, for protection of sovereignty of the state, it is being used for sovereignty or protection of a political party. Now, the hallmark of good legislation is this, that it should be definite and it should be incapable of misinterpretation. Here, unfortunately, it is so vague and therefore it is misinterpreted. A person who says that cow's urine is not good for COVID is also put behind the bars for UAPA. Now, that is absurd, absolutely. And it is because of this, the vagueness in the act, that, you know, it is being misused. Now, the second thing is that we must understand the chronology. Aajkal chronology to bahut chronology bahut popular shabd hai, to isko hum bhi apne istemal karte hain. As we know, you know that the United Nations Human Rights Convention, that, you know, came in 1948, and Article 11 specifically said that every person has a right to presumption of innocence. After that came our constitution in 1950, in which Article 23 said that a person has a right to keep, has a right against self-incrimination, which in effect means that he has a right to silence. After that, in 1976, came the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. Article 14.2 once again reiterates what is said in the human rights document. So it is unchallenged that actually the presumption of innocence should not be dislodged. Now, what has happened is that there are certain things, you know, that we need to understand about criminal jurisprudence. There are certain basic fundamentals where the present UAPA is concerned, we need to understand. One is presumption of innocence. The second is right to silence. The third is burden of proof is on the prosecution to prove its case beyond all reasonable doubt. And then fourth is the higher the punishment, the greater the burden of the on the prosecution. Now, when we see section 43D, it says that that is of the opinion there are reasonable grounds for bearing that the accusation against that person is prima facie true. So you cannot grant bail to the person if it is prima facie true. Second is 43E, it says that the court shall presume, unless the contrary is shown, that the accused has committed such offense. Now, unless the contrary is shown, now who's supposed to show this contrary? Obviously, the accused. Now, when, you know, our Evidence Act 106 is very clear that it is only when facts within your special knowledge is there, only those facts need to be proved. Otherwise, the burden is on the prosecution. So when 113A, I mean, when it was amended, the Evidence Act 113A about dowry death and suicide, it did not say that it is to be shown. The contrary is to be shown. It only said that once the prosecution has proved its case, then you are to presume all this. Now, presume all this, the courts have already said that just because there is a presumption clause does not mean, you know, that the prosecution is not supposed to discharge its initial burden. That has to be necessarily discharged. Once that is done, only then the presumption could be shifted or the onus could be shifted. The point is here, you have put, you know, the defense as well as the prosecution in equal footing. So once the prosecution does one work, then the accused is supposed to, the defense is supposed to show that he is not guilty. Now this is absurd. It is not proper in an adversarial system. It cannot be done. Now the second thing, you know, is about on conditions of bail. The point is, you know, that the word that is used is the court shall not grant him bail unless prima facie shall not, you know, the person shall not be granted bail, etc. They do not specify which court it means. Now, as we know, you know, that we have an inverted pyramid where discretion is concerned. So the Supreme Court, it comes right on the top and it's got the widest discretion. Then comes the High Court, then the session judge or magistrate, whoever. The point is that the designated court is the session judge. After that, the High Court, when it comes to the High Court, it does not have any higher, wider discretion. Nor does the Supreme Court. And therefore, in the article I've written, so the Supreme Court becomes interchangeable with the magistrate or the designated court. This is absurd. You cannot possibly do it. The High Court has to have wider wider discretion. That's the whole concept of CRPC. That was why, you know, that there was separation of powers, etc., etc. When the new court came into existence, they made sure, you know, that the conditions for bail, that were bifurcated in two sections. One was for the magistrate and the second was for the High Court and the session judge. How could you just disregard this? And when it, unfortunately, you know, when TADA, the provision of TADA, when it was challenged before the constitutional bench in 1967, I think it was. So what happened was that in TADA, there was no appeal to the High Court. The appeal was to come to the Supreme Court straight away. So the High Court was bypassed. There was, you know, a challenge to it. This challenge, the presumption of innocence, because there was about the conditions, twin conditions on bail, confessions, etc. The Supreme Court completely forgot to answer the question that what happened to the presumption of innocence. And therefore, you know, it says that in the national interest, the legislation can bring in such acts, such laws. The point is not, you know, that whether the legislature can bring or not. The point is, you know, whether the Supreme Court and the judiciary, whether courts, you know, as the protector of human rights, as the protector of everyone's rights, is failing its duty to not think that, you know, in future there could be a possibility of a misuse, which we are seeing now. Now, what is happening? The High Court doesn't do anything. The Supreme Court says, if the High Court does, the Supreme Court says, how come, you know, you've done it? And the High Court says, no, the Supreme Court also says, no, we're not supposed to grant bail. This is absurd. What happens to a person's, you know, the person's protection of civil rights? So you can go to hell, the executive can commit excesses, but the courts will not be able to come to, you know, your rescue. And now, why did we come to this pass? Because of the constitutional bench decision, I would think. It is unfortunate, you know, that this happened. Now, in the end, you know, I'm also in a hurry, and I'm sure all of you are also sufficiently bored, but I wanted to just, you know, TADA, it's, you know, all these acts, the amendments in UAPA came in after the 9/11 happened in the US in 2001. And then, you know, the UN, they sat together, and the UN Security Council, they passed a resolution called 1373, in, you know, where the states are supposed to endeavor, et cetera, et cetera, for security, et cetera. So it was all, you know, concerning whatever had happened with the US. I'm not, you know, concerned with that. Later on, what happened was that another amendment by which, you know, all these rights, etc., the presumption of innocence, etc., was laid to rest. That came in the year 2008. And there, you know, in the objects and the purpose, etc., they mentioned a number of resolutions of the UN. They all pertain to the Middle East, to the Al-Qaeda, sanctions against Osama, etc., etc. How is it relevant to our domestic laws? I don't understand this. And therefore, you know, what has happened is that recently, this is now very, very important. You know, every year they keep having some kind of a meeting in the UN. And recently, on the 12th of January, 2021, Ambassador Richard Mills, Deputy Permanent Representative, U.S. Mission to the United Nations, he delivered, a lecture as in the 20th anniversary of Resolution 1373. I'll just read two lines. As colleagues have mentioned, history has also shown us over and over again that measures to prevent and counter terrorism that come at the expense of human rights and the rule of law are counterproductive. That is why the United States will continue to object to certain countries' actions to engage in mass detention of religious minorities and members of other minorities. Now then, thereafter, governments, including governments sadly represented in this council, must not use counterterrorism as a pretext for stifling freedom of religion or belief or other human rights and fundamental freedoms. So even the Security Council has come, you know, has come to this conclusion that actually there is blatant misuse. There is an abuse of these provisions. And taking the refuge, you know, hiding behind these high-sounding resolutions of the UN, This is what is happening. And nobody raises a question. But how could the courts have, you know, failed us? I fail to understand this. This is the only thing I wish to say. I'm sorry, Aftab sir. And Justice Madan Lokur and Justice Gowda, all judges of the Supreme Court. I'm sorry.
Thank you very much.
Why should you be sorry? You spoke so well. So thank you very much.
Impassioned as I am always, sir. Sir, please may I be excused, sir. I have a family commitment. I may be excused, sir. Anjali?
Yes, thank you so much, Justice Prakash. I know that you have a personal commitment and you still joined us and you very patiently
sat through the entire discussion.
Thank you very much for making these very important points. मैं बहुत ही संक्षिप्त में हिंदी में अनुवाद करने की कोशिश करती हूँ कुछ पॉइंट्स का, कुछ बिंदुओं का केवल. उन्होंने कहा कि वो बिल्कुल सहमत हैं अभी तक सभी जो बातें हुई कि जो करंट फॉर्म है, जो अभी जिस शेप में UAPA है, वो बिल्कुल ही एक्सेप्टेबल नहीं है. उसे हम नहीं मान सकते कि वो सही है, क्योंकि वो इतना वेग है और उसमें लोगों की जो स्वतंत्रता है, व्यक्तिगत स्वतंत्रता है, उसके ऊपर पूरी तरह से खतरा मंडराता है जब तक ये कानून है. उन्होंने कहा कि जो ऐसे से कानून जब लाए जाते हैं, आतंकवाद के खिलाफ जब कानून लाए जाते हैं, उनका काम होता है कि वो देश की स्वतंत्रता को प्रोटेक्ट करें, उसकी सुरक्षा करें. पर अभी कुछ ऐसा होता दिख रहा है कि एक किसी पॉलिटिकल पार्टी की सुरक्षा के लिए इन कानूनों का इस्तेमाल हो रहा है. और उन्होंने क्रोनोलॉजी समझाई. उन्होंने कहा कि आजकल क्रोनोलॉजी की बहुत चर्चा होती है और उन्होंने क्रोनोलॉजी भी समझाई. और उन्होंने फिर ये कहा कि किस तरीके से समय समय पर लोगों को अधिकार दिए गए हैं जिससे कि वो अपने आप का बचाव कर सकें. राइट टू साइलेंस की भी बात की उन्होंने. फिर सिविल एंड पॉलिटिकल राइट्स हमें कैसे मिली हैं उसकी भी बात की. और उन्होंने बेसिकली ये कहा कि हमारे संविधान में और हमारा जो लोकतंत्र है उसमें लोगों को माना जाता है कि वो इनोसेंट हैं. उन्होंने क्राइम नहीं किया है जब तक कि वो प्रूव ना हो सके, ये दिखाया ना जा सके कि उन्होंने कुछ गलत काम किया है, वो तब तक इनोसेंट हैं. और इस जो बेसिक पैराडाइम है इसको डिसलॉज नहीं किया जाना चाहिए, इसे किसी भी कीमत पर हटाया नहीं जा सकता. और उन्होंने कहा कि जो 43D है UAPA का, जिसकी पहले भी चर्चा हो चुकी है, उनका मानना है कि वो बहुत ही दिक्कत देने वाला एक सेक्शन है. और उन्होंने ये मेंशन किया कि किस तरीके से वो जो सेक्शन है वो पूरी तरह से जिसके ऊपर मुकदमा डाला जाता है, जिसको अक्यूज्ड बनाया जाता है, उसके ऊपर बर्डन डाल देता है प्रूव करने का कि वो इनोसेंट है. और उन्होंने कहा इस तरीके की चीज तो कहीं पर भी नहीं देखी गई है. डाउरी लॉज की भी उन्होंने चर्चा की, लेकिन ऐसी चीज जो UAPA के सेक्शन 43D कर रहा है, ये तो बिल्कुल ही गलत है और किसी भी तरीके से इसको जस्टिफाई नहीं किया जा सकता. उन्होंने ये भी कहा कि वटाली जजमेंट का भी उन्होंने जिक्र किया, पर 43D के कॉन्टेक्स्ट में उन्होंने ये भी कहा कि कैसे हम ये मान सकते हैं कि सुप्रीम कोर्ट का और हाई कोर्ट का जो दायरा है वो सेशंस कोर्ट जज के जो दायरा है उससे बड़ा नहीं है, और उनके पास बेल देने की जो ताकत है उससे पूरी तरह से रिस्ट्रिक्ट कैसे किया जा सकता है. और अंत में उन्होंने ये भी कहा कि जो हमारी जो संवैधानिक अधिकार हैं, हमारे मौलिक अधिकार हैं, सुप्रीम कोर्ट और हाई कोर्ट्स का दायित्व बनता है कि वो प्रोटेक्ट हों. और ये जो सारे अमेंडमेंट्स आए हैं UAPA में, 2001 में जो अमेरिका में 9/11 सितंबर 11 में जो अटैक्स हुए थे, उसके बाद यूएन में जो रेजोल्यूशंस हुई उसको मद्देनजर रखते हुए, उसका हवाला देते हुए 2008 में संशोधन लाए गए जो कि अलकायदा और अलग अलग जगहों से का वास्ता दे रहे थे, उनका हमारे देश से क्या ताल्लुक है ये बिल्कुल क्लियर नहीं है उनका कहना है। और उन्होंने फाइनली ये कहा कि 12 जनवरी 2021 को सिक्योरिटी काउंसिल में भी बात हुई, उन्होंने कहा कि ये कहा गया जो यूएस के नुमाइंदे थे, उन्होंने कहा कि टेररिज्म आतंकवाद को कंट्रोल करने के नाम पर लोगों को जेल में डालना, उनको प्रताड़ित करना, माइनॉरिटीज को और अलग और अब्यूज ऑफ इस तरीके का जो पावर है ये बिल्कुल सहा नहीं जा सकता। और उन्होंने इसी के साथ में अपनी बात समाप्त की कि यूएपीए जैसे कानून का जिस फॉर्म में अभी वो है वो उसकी कोई जगह नहीं है हमारे संविधान के तहत हमारे लोकतंत्र में। तो बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद जस्टिस प्रकाश का। एंड नाउ आई वुड लाइक टू रिक्वेस्ट जस्टिस लोकुर, एंड बिफोर जस्टिस लोकुर स्पीक्स आई वांट टू आल्सो एक्नॉलेज दैट जस्ट एंड थैंक जस्टिस लोकुर फॉर ऑल हिज हेल्प इन मेकिंग दिस possible, this discussion, this public discussion possible today. So last but not the least, we are requesting Justice Loku to speak to us, and he is going to focus on, is it time to move towards a system of compensation and reparation for those acquitted after long periods of wrongful incarceration? Because finally, we need to talk about accountability. We need to talk about compensation for those who have been wrongfully treated under these laws. So over to you, Justice Lokur.
Thank you. Thank you, Anjali. And thank you for organizing this, Anjali and Prashant, and for the wonderful, you know, really wonderful presentations that we've had from Justice Aftab Alam, Justice Gopala Gowda, Justice Deepak Gupta, Anjana Prakash. It's really been very, very enlightening. Now, you know, the question that I have been asked is that should there be a system of compensation and reparation for those who are acquitted after long periods of incarceration? I can answer that in one word. The answer is yes, there should be. But I would like to go much beyond that, you know, because it's not only being in jail and then, you know, getting acquitted. There are several other things for which I think compensation should be given. Now, all the speakers, you know, have indicated that sedition, UAPA should go. But my view is it is not going to go anywhere. These two laws are not going anywhere. They are going to remain where they are. On the other hand, NSA is being added to this. So you have Manipur. So you have Uttar Pradesh, where the Allahabad High Court struck down some 90 orders under NSA. So it's not only these two, but we are going to have NSA also now pretty active to quell dissent and stop people from talking about these kind of things. So coming back to the topic of compensation, I just want to go back a little bit into history. It's not something new that compensation is being talked about today. It has been there a long time back. I will just mention very briefly five judgments given by the Supreme Court. The first one is of Rudul Shah, 1983. He was acquitted. Unfortunately, he was in jail even after acquittal. He was acquitted in 1968, but he was released in 1982 after 14 years. The Supreme Court gave him compensation of 30,000 rupees, which may have been quite a lot at that time, but also gave him the right to file a civil suit for compensation. Sebastian Hongre, 1984, he was picked up by the police and disappeared. The Supreme Court said, "You please produce this Sebastian Hongre." Police said, no, we have not picked him up. right? But the evidence showed that he was picked up by the police, and because he was not produced, it was presumed that he was dead. In any case, he had disappeared. The Supreme Court gave his family 1 lakh rupees as compensation. Professor Bhim Singh, he was an MLA in Legislative Assembly of Jammu and Kashmir, 1985. He was going to attend the assembly session, and he was picked up and not permitted to attend the assembly session. He filed a case. He's a professor, also a lawyer. He filed a case. Supreme Court said, how can you just pick up a person like this and just, you know, pick him up and take him away? He was given 50,000 rupees compensation. 1989, Saheli, an NGO, they filed a case with regard to death in police custody. 75,000 rupees was granted by the Supreme Court as compensation. Neelapati Behra, her son died in police custody. His body was found near some railway tracks. 1993, the Supreme Court gave 1,50,000 rupees as compensation. So this is not something new. The Supreme Court has been giving compensation for these kind of disappearances, you know, picking up, you know, death in police custody long time ago. But for some reason, I don't know why, after that, after this Neelapati Behra's case in 1993, these kind of illegal arrests did not take place. I don't know. But anyway, the culture of compensation more or less died down. Now we are faced with this problem once again. So you had Nambi Narayanan, a very eminent scientist. He was detained. Supreme Court said, give him 50 lakhs as compensation. Look at some of the other cases that we are faced with today. Nambi Narayanan was, a few years ago. Akhil Gogoi, arrested and detained under UAPA for more than 1 year. He was discharged. He was not even acquitted. It was a discharge, so no offense was made out. No compensation. There was a mention that there should be some guidelines and all that, under UAPA sedition and all that. Munawar Farooqi, recently this year, he was released by the Supreme Court. Why? Because the police who had arrested him did not follow the guidelines laid down by the Supreme Court in the case of Arnesh Kumar in 2014. So the Supreme Court may lay down guidelines, but if the police says we don't want to follow it, we will not follow it. Munawar Farooqi was arrested, Supreme Court released him. No compensation for illegal arrest. Muhammad Habib, a man from Tripura, was detained in Bangalore and in jail for 4 years. Discharged. No case made out. No case of acquittal. He was discharged. No case made out. No compensation. Persons who are directed to be released but are not released. Long time back, about 25 years ago in Delhi High Court, one person or two persons, they were directed to be released from Tihar Jail. Tihar Jail said, no, we're not releasing them. They kept them inside for another 15 days. The court said, pay compensation. Sanjay Dutt, he was released by the Supreme Court, granted bail by the Supreme Court. For 2 days, he was in jail in Pune. Why? Because the order could not reach Pune. All right. Delhi, 3 activists who were released, who were granted bail recently. What does the police say? Prosecution, they say, Aadhaar card chahiye. Unka address check karna hai. You know, so they're supposed to be in jail. Did they not check the Aadhaar card when they arrested them? Did they not check the address when they arrested them? What is all this going on? You know, so orders passed by the courts. अगर हम उसे पालना चाहते हैं हम करेंगे नहीं नहीं चाहते तो नहीं करेंगे आगरा जेल अभी रिसेंटली 2 हफ्ते पहले persons who claimed to be juveniles had been inside for 14 between 14 and 22 years Supreme Court said, release them. Agra jail said, no, you will not. Ek do din, they remained in jail until Supreme Court said, listen, we are going to take action. Then they said, all right. What is the consequence of this? The consequence of this is that this Manipur activist, Supreme Court said, listen, you better release him by 5 o'clock. Now, can you imagine? This is the state that we have come to, where the courts have to say, ki isko 5 baje tak release karo, ya 6 baje tak release karo. That is the duty of the prison authorities, of the police, to release a person when the court says you release him. You can't say, I will release him whenever I feel like it. You know, you can go on passing orders. Jo hume karna hai, wo hum karenge. No compensation in any of these cases, except for the Tihar jail. This fellow got 1,000 rupees a day for the 15 days that he was there. Fake encounters. No compensation for fake encounters. We had to deal with a case. Justice Deepak Gupta was there with me on the bench. A 12-year-old boy in Manipur was shot in the back on the ground that he is a terrorist who is trying to run away. Justice Santosh Hegde, a very eminent judge who had retired by that time, was asked to look into it, and he said it was a fake encounter. No such thing happened. But I said, theek hai, you know, compensation not given until, you know, we had to intervene. UP, 119 people have been killed in fake encounters. You know, that thok do policy, 119 people. Now, all of them were trying to run away. All of them were trying to snatch guns from the police. All of them were deadly criminals. How is that? Has any inquiry been conducted? Or just because the police shoots them, they say, theek hai, you know, they're dreaded criminals, this, that, and the other, as a part of that thok do policy. Assam, now, if a person tries to run away or something, just shoot him. So, 5 people have been killed already in fake encounters. What about compensation for them? So, it's not only, cases of acquittal, but there are so many other kind of cases where compensation must be given. Long detention for many, many years. And again, no compensation given. Surat, the case in Surat was mentioned, 122 people, all of them were not in jail for 19 years, but some of them were in jail for some time. Acquitted, no compensation. Bashir Ahmed Baba, a person from Kashmir, he was going to Gujarat to attend an anti-cancer camp. Right? They said, you're a terrorist, and they put him inside. He was inside for 11 years. What was he going to do? He was going to attend an anti-cancer camp so that he could help the people in Kashmir to understand how to treat cancer and what to deal with cancer. But they put him inside for 11 years, acquitted. No compensation. Agra jail, I have mentioned. 14 to 22 years, people have been in jail. So, it's not, you know, just a question of acquittal. There could be an acquittal for a variety of reasons. But the whole process, you know, starting from arrest, as in the case of this Mohammed Farooqi, starting from arrest until the framing of charges, until the trial, until the acquittal, the whole thing has to be looked into. So it is very, very important. You know, it's nice to say that UAPA should go, sedition should go. But like I said, I don't think they're going to go. They're not going to go. And like I said, probably NSA is now going to be used. So how do people deal with this situation? The only way is accountability, and accountability has to be in 2 forms. One is financial accountability, where compensation has to be given. And give them sufficient amount of compensation. If you can give Nambi Narayanan 50 lakhs, surely you can give some good amount of compensation to all these people who have been,
you know, wrongly arrested, wrongly detained. Why not? And once the courts start telling the police or the prosecution that, listen, you better pay 5 lakhs, 10 lakhs, whatever, I think they'll probably come to their senses. That is one aspect. The second aspect, which we have not looked into at all, because we think that, 5 lakh rupees is given, sab theek ho jayega. There's a lot of mental trauma. Not only for the person who believes he's innocent and is eventually proved to be innocent, that person undergoes severe mental trauma for being in jail for many, many years for something that he has not done, some false charges or some useless charges like they've done in Manipur, that he says something about Gaumutra and put him under NSA. What about the mental frame of mind of that person? What about the psychological impact? What about the emotional impact on him? What about the psychological, emotional impact on his family, his children? They will go to school and they will be told, oh, you know, your father is in jail. Why? Because he's a terrorist. Why? Because he has committed sedition. Why? Because he's a national security threat. And what has he done? He has done nothing. He has gone to attend a camp on anti-cancer, and for 11 years he's there. The child will go through school in 11 years or 12 years. We are not looking at that mental aspect. And that is also very, very important, because you're going to be, you know, having people who are frustrated, whose families are frustrated, whose friends are frustrated, whose relatives are frustrated, that here is a man who is innocent and wrongly incarcerated. And for what? For something which he hasn't done. What is the kind of society that we are trying to develop, through this process? There is now developing something called soft torture. We know about third degree methods. We know about second degree methods. You have soft torture. Overcrowding in jails, where in a cell for one person, there are four persons over there. So who has to sleep on the platform? That the stronger man will decide. So inconvenience at the time of sleeping. Hygiene not provided or pretty bad. I have been to some observation homes for children. In a dormitory of 50 children, they're supposed to be 50, they may have been more, but at least 50, one toilet. What kind of hygiene do you expect? Jails are perhaps slightly better, I don't know. Isn't that torture of some kind? Nutrition. We have dietitians talking about how much food to eat and what not to eat, when to eat. Is all this being studied for the prisoners? What about child prisoners? You had children in detention under Public Safety Act in Jammu and Kashmir. What was the nutrition given to them? Do we know? What about the hygiene? Do we know? Isn't that some kind of torture? Medical facilities? Isn't a person entitled to proper medical facilities? Even if he's a prisoner, so what if he's a prisoner? So you have somebody like Honey Babu, whose eye is in a very bad shape, and when it appears that he might lose his eye, okay, then now we will send you to a hospital. But not before that. Stan Swamy, everybody has talked about Stan Swamy. Why could he not be given medical treatment earlier? Isn't that torture? Soft torture. It is not, that physical kind of torture where you beat up a person and, it's not like that. But it is a form of torture. There was a report recently of a person who is allowed to go out from his cell for 2 hours in a day. So 22 hours he is locked up. Almost solitary confinement, or equivalent to solitary confinement. Isn't that torture? So let's look at the whole thing, you know. Let's not look at one aspect, you know, which Anjali and Prashant have asked me to look at, you know, acquittal after long periods of incarceration. Let's look at the whole thing. Where are we heading? That is the question. What is the remedy? Compensation is one. Accountability is another. Mental health is equally important, if not more important, because this is going to remain for the rest of their life, not only for their life, but for the life of their family, the life of their children. They will remember it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Justice Lokur. That was very, very fascinating, and also, you know, very powerfully you made the points about the need for not just compensation, and we can't just only look at the case of acquittal, but we need to adopt a far more comprehensive view when we are looking at these cases and when people are wrongfully you know, they're brought under these laws. Justice Lokur ne bahut sari cheezon ke upar charcha ki hai. Main bahut sankshipt mein unme se kuch cheezon ki charcha kar deti hu. Unhone shuru mein hi keh diya ke agar wo baat kar rahe hain ki kya muawza diya jana chahiye लोगों को जिनको कि गलत तरीके से लंबे अरसों तक कई बार जेल के अंदर रखा जाता है यूएपीए और देशद्रोह के कानूनों के तहत, उनका मानना है कि बिल्कुल दिया जाना चाहिए. लेकिन उन्होंने कहा कि हमें इसके इससे आगे बढ़ के देखना भी होगा और इसको गहराई में समझना भी होगा कि क्या हो रहा है. और उन्होंने शुरू बात अपनी करी हमसे ये कहते हुए कि हम आज ये डिस्कस तो कर रहे हैं, हम ये चर्चा तो कर रहे हैं कि क्या ये कानून होने चाहिए हैं, यूआपा का और देशद्रोह का कानून क्या हमारे देश में होना चाहिए कि नहीं. लेकिन हम सब चाहे माने भी कि ये कानून नहीं होने चाहिए, कहीं जाने नहीं वाले. बल्कि उन्होंने ये कहा कि ऐसा दिख रहा है साफ तौर पे कि जाने की बात तो दूर, ये कानून, इन कानूनों का दुरुपयोग बढ़ता जाएगा हमारे देश में जैसे हालात हैं. आप मणिपुर में देख लीजिए, उत्तर प्रदेश में देख लीजिए. उत्तर प्रदेश में इलाहाबाद हाईकोर्ट ने हाल ही में 90 ऐसे केसेस के को स्ट्राइक डाउन करा है जहां पे एनएसए गलत तरीके से लगाया गया. और उन्होंने कहा बल्कि सेडिशन, देशद्रोह और युवापा में तो अब एनएसए नेशनल सिक्योरिटी एक्ट भी अब उसमें जोड़ा जा रहा है लोगों को प्रताड़ित करने के लिए जो अपना विरोध जताते हैं सरकार की नीतियों और कानूनों के खिलाफ, जो गलत कानून होते हैं और अन्याय के खिलाफ. जब हम मुआवजे की बात करते हैं, उन्होंने कहा कि पहले बहुत से ऐसे केसेस हैं जहां पर मुआवजा दिया जाता था. उन्होंने बताया कि किस तरह से 1984 के बहुत सारे केसेस हैं जहां पर लोगों को जब गलत तरीके से पाया गया कि उन्हें जेल में रखा गया तो उन्हें मुआवजा दिया गया. मुआवजा बहुत ज़्यादा ना भी हो लेकिन उस समय पर 30,000 रुपये, 50,000 रुपये, 1,00,000 रुपये का मुआवजा दिया गया और वो भी काफ़ी एक अमाउंट था और ज़रूरी भी था कि ये दिया गया मुआवजा. उन्होंने ये भी केसेस बहुत सारे गिनाए, शाह केस, सेबेस्टियन होंगरे केस और भीम सिंह जो एमएलए थे जम्मू कश्मीर के, उन्हें जब उठाया गया जब वो लेजिस्लेटिव असेंबली में जा रहे थे, उनका केस बताया. उन्होंने सहेली जो संस्था है महिलाओं के मुद्दे पर जो काम करती है, उन्होंने जब किसी की जब पुलिस की कस्टडी में मौत हुई उसका केस लेके गई तो 75,000 रुपये का मुआवजा दिया गया. ये सारे केसेस उन्होंने हमें गिनाए. लेकिन उन्होंने कहा कि एकदम से ये कल्चर जो था मुआवजा देने का वो खत्म हो गया, और ये उनका मानना है कि ये बहुत इसके ऊपर सोचने की ज़रूरत है। कुछ केसेस ऐसे हुए हैं हाल में जहाँ पर मुआवजा दिया गया है, जैसे कि नबी नारायण जो साइंटिस्ट हैं नारायणन, उनका केस था जिसमें 50 लाख रुपए का मुआवजा दिया गया। लेकिन इतने सारे ऐसे केसेस हैं, अखिल गगोई का केस देख लीजिए, उन्होंने कहा कि एक साल तक उन्हें जेल में रखा गया इन कानूनों के तहत, और उन्हें फिर डिस्चार्ज किया गया। ये भी नहीं कि उनकी रिहाई हुई, उन्हें एक्विट किया गया, मतलब डिस्चार्ज किया गया कि कोई ऑफेंस ही नहीं था बना, और फिर भी एक साल को उन्हें जेल में रहना पड़ा और उन्हें कोई मुआवजा नहीं दिया गया। मुनावर फारूकी की उन्होंने बात करी, जिनके केस में हमने अभी गाइडलाइंस की बात करी थी, उन्होंने कहा गाइडलाइंस होने के बावजूद 2014 से गाइडलाइंस फॉलो नहीं हुई, लेकिन और पुलिस ने गाइडलाइंस फॉलो नहीं किए, स्पष्ट भी हो गया, लेकिन मुआवजा नहीं दिया गया इसके बावजूद कि उन्हें जेल में रखा गया। मोहम्मद हबीब का उन्होंने केस बताया जिन्हें 4 साल तक बेंगलोर में जेल में रखा गया और डिस्चार्ज किया गया फाइनली, लेकिन मुआवजा नहीं दिया गया। ऐसे तमाम उन्होंने हमें केसेस बताए, लेकिन उन्होंने कहा कि ये जो तकलीफ और जो प्रॉब्लम है ये तो इसीलिए कि ये केवल रिहाइश तक लिमिटेड नहीं है, हमें इसको और ब्रॉडन करके और खोल के भी देखना होगा और गहराई में देखना होगा। क्योंकि उन्होंने कहा कि इतनी केसेस हो रहे हैं जहां पर सरकारें और पुलिस, कोर्ट क्लियरली ऑर्डर दे देता है, जजमेंट दे देता है, वो उसकी उसका पालना भी नहीं कर रही हैं उन ऑर्डर्स की भी। और उसमें भी उन्होंने गिनाया कि किस तरीके से इतने केसेस हुए हैं हाल में जहां पर कोर्ट्स ने कह दिया है कि आप रिहा कर दीजिए लोगों को, आप तुरंत छोड़ दीजिए जो जेल में हैं लोग, लेकिन उन ऑर्डर्स के बावजूद भी उन्हें छोड़ा नहीं जाता जब तक फिर से कोर्ट इंटरवीन ना करे। और उसमें उन्होंने तिहाड़ जेल का में जो बंद कैदी थे उनकी बात करी। अभी हाल ही में जो 3 एक्टिविस्ट जिनको बेल दी गई हाई कोर्ट, दिल्ली हाई कोर्ट के द्वारा दिल्ली रायट्स के मैटर में, किसी ना किसी बहाने से, आधार कार्ड चेक करने के बहाने से, उनका एड्रेस चेक करने के बहाने से उन्हें छोड़ा नहीं गया, रिलीज नहीं किया गया जब तक कि वो वापस नहीं गए हाई कोर्ट और उन्होंने अपनी रिलीज के लिए आगे बात नहीं करी और कोर्ट ने कहा नहीं तब तक। आगरा जेल में जहां 14 से 22 साल तक लोगों को जेल में रखा गया, जो जुविनाइल भी कई लोग थे, और उनकी जब रिहाई हुई तब तक नहीं हुई जब तक सुप्रीम कोर्ट ने नहीं कहा, स्टेप इन नहीं किया, और कोई मुआवजा नहीं है। मणिपुर के जर्नलिस्ट जिनकी बात हुई है, उनको जब रिहाई का ऑर्डर आया तो कोर्ट को यहाँ तक कहना पड़ा कि 5 बजे तक उन्हें रिहा किया जाए। तो मतलब ये दिखा रहा है कि हमारे देश में क्या हाल हो रहा है, और कोर्ट्स की भी जो ऑर्डर्स हैं उनके आने के बावजूद जब इन कानूनों का इस्तेमाल किया जा रहा है, गलत तरीके से इस्तेमाल किया जा रहा है, वो किस तरह से कोर्ट्स के ऑर्डर्स का भी उनमें पालना कई बार नहीं होती जब तक कोर्ट्स फिर आके अपनी ऑर्डर्स की पालना ना कराएं। और उन्होंने ये भी कहा कि मुआवजे की जब हम बात करते हैं तो फेक एनकाउंटर्स को नहीं छोड़ा जा सकता, जिसमें जो पुलिस है वो ये कह देती है कि मुजरिम भाग रहा था और एकदम से उस गोलियां उन पर दाग दी जाती हैं। एक ऐसे एनकाउंटर में उन्होंने कहा कि 12 साल के एक लड़के को, एक बच्चे के पीठ में गोलियां मारकर उसकी हत्या हुई, और जब उसमें देखा गया डिटेल में तो जस्टिस लोकुर और जस्टिस दीपक गुप्ता ने भी एक केस था, और जब फाइंडिंग्स आई जस्टिस संतोष हेगड़े ने इसमें देखा तो वो पाया गया कि फेक एनकाउंटर था। तो सुप्रीम कोर्ट ने जब तक इंटरव्यू नहीं किया उसमें भी कॉम्पनसेशन का कुछ नहीं दिया गया। और 119 लोग हाल ही में यूपी में, ये जो यूपी की ठोक दो पॉलिसी है जस्टिस लोकुर ने कहा, जो आजकल फॉलो हो रही है कि मतलब कहा जाता है कि बहुत बढ़िया काम हो रहा है और क्रिमिनल्स खत्म हो रहे हैं और उसके तहत लोगों को मार दिया जाता है जब उनको गिल्टी करार नहीं हो रहे हैं और लोगों को ऐसे ही मार दिया जा रहा है। तो उन्होंने कहा ये सब के बावजूद मुआवजे की कोई बात नहीं है और मुआवजे के बियॉन्ड भी जाने की ज़रूरत है, जवाबदेही की ज़रूरत है, क्योंकि लोकतंत्र में कितने भी अच्छे कानून हो, कोर्ट्स भी करें, लेकिन जब तक जवाबदेही नहीं सुनिश्चित की जाएगी तब तक ये जो कल्चर जो चल रहा है वो नहीं जाएगा। और उन्होंने बात करी बशीर अहमद बाबा की, जिन्हें की जो कश्मीर से थे और एक कैंसर एंटी कैंसर कैंप के लिए जा रहे थे, उन्हें पकड़ के 11 साल तक जेल में डाल दिया गया था। तो जस्टिस लोकुर ने सवाल उठाया है कि क्या ऐसे लोगों को जेल में डाला जाना चाहिए और उनके ऊपर क्या बीतती है, उनके परिवार पर क्या बीतती है। और उन्होंने जिक्र किया सॉफ्ट टॉर्चर का, उन्होंने कहा कि अभी जो हम देख रहे हैं केवल ये नहीं है, टॉर्चर के केसेस तो एक चीज़ है और वो कंसर्निंग है ही, लेकिन सॉफ्ट टॉर्चर की पूरी मुद्दे के ऊपर भी उन्होंने रोशनी डाली कि किस तरह से जेलों में क्या हालात हैं, कितनी ओवर क्राउडिंग है जेलों के अंदर, भरे हुए हैं लोग कैदियों को, सही से सफाई नहीं है, न्यूट्रिशन लोगों को खाने की जो गुणवत्ता है उसकी कोई ध्यान नहीं है, और सॉलिटरी कन्फाइनमेंट में अकेले में लोगों को डाल दिया जाता है, तो और फिर मेडिकल फैसिलिटीज तक नहीं दी जाती। तो उन्होंने उसमें ये भी बताया कैसे हैनी बाबू की आँख का हम जान रहे हैं रिपोर्ट से कि उनकी कितनी बुरी हालत है, जब तक वो पूरा नहीं प्रॉब्लम हो जाता तब तक नहीं बेल होता, उनको नहीं सही से मेडिकल फैसिलिटीज़ नहीं मिलती हैं। फादर स्टैन स्वामी की इतनी चर्चा हुई है अभी आज पैनल पर भी कि कैसे इतनी बुरी हालत थी उनके स्वास्थ्य की और उसके बावजूद उन्हें बेल नहीं दी गई। तो जस्टिस लोकुर ने कहा कि हम कहाँ जा रहे हैं एज अ सोसाइटी, हमें ये सोचना होगा, हमें सोचना होगा कि हम क्या कर सकते हैं ठोस तरीके से इन सब चीज़ों को सही करने के लिए। UAPA, NSA और सेडिशन जैसे कानून होने चाहिए, नहीं होने चाहिए, इनके ऊपर हम चर्चा भी कर सकते हैं और ये भी मान सकते हैं कि ऐसे कानून नहीं होने चाहिए, मौजूदा तरीके से जैसे कानून है UAPA का वो भी बिल्कुल नहीं होने चाहिए, लेकिन वो कहीं जाने वाले नहीं दिख रहे। तो अब हम किधर बढ़ें। और उन्होंने कहा कि तीन चीज़ों से उन्होंने अपनी बात समाप्त की कि जवाबदेही की ज़रूरत है, बहुत सख्त ज़रूरत है उन्होंने कहा, और उन्होंने कहा कि मुआवजा देने के लिए बहुत सही कदम उठाए जाने की ज़रूरत है, और बहुत सख्त ज़रूरत है कि लोगों को जिनको कि ऐसे ऐसे कानूनों के तहत पकड़ा जा रहा है, उन्हें सालों साल जेल डाला जा रहा है, उनके मेंटल हेल्थ की, उनके परिवार के, उनके बच्चों के, जिनको कि बार बार ये सुनना पड़ता है कि उनके पिता या उनकी माता टेररिस्ट हैं, आतंकवादी हैं, जेल में हैं, उनकी मेंटल हेल्थ की के ऊपर भी ध्यान देने की ज़रूरत है। तो बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद जस्टिस लोकुर, मेनी थैंक्स एंड फॉर अ वेरी वेरी रिच यू नो टॉक दैट एंड bringing out all of these various issues at the end of the very rich discussion that we have had. On behalf of CJAR and HRDA, I'm going to request Henry, if you could please unmute yourself and please give the vote of thanks. Henry. Henry, you'll need to unmute yourself, please.
Anjali, thank you. Let me thank Justice Alam for the performance audit that you have provided, and categorically stating that the UAPA has failed us. Justice Gowda, as usual, for telling us that greater powers means greater responsibility and providing us an analysis of a variety of judgments of the Supreme Court. Justice Deepak Gupta telling us categorically that the sedition law has to be shown the door and reminding us that the need for guidelines and the role of superior courts has to be emphasized. Justice Anjana Prakash for highlighting the vagueness of the act and showing how the Supreme Court itself has become interchangeable with the NIA court, and she said it with pain. And a series of United Nations resolutions being used, which are totally out of context in the Indian context for justifying the amendments brought to the UAPA. And Justice Madan Lokur for categorically telling us that accountability is the way today, not only financial, but also to attend to the issues of mental trauma and also the issue of compensation. To all of you, a big thank you. A thank you because our democracy stands better protected today with all the five of you who have addressed the nation. You have not addressed the participants. For all the five of you for having stood with us and stood with many others in upholding the constitution morality of our country and speaking out. And I want to assure you all that you, all what you said is being followed in a nationwide campaign of hundreds of organizations who will be taking your messages to the nook and corner of this country. And the assurance that Anjali gave will be an assurance that will be followed, that this will be translated into regional languages and made available in different fora to ensure that people continuously get educated on what has been said. And to you, Anjali, for that wonderful translation, the translation which I didn't understand, but the passion I understood, and I'm sure the judges understood it much better. The consistency of the passion that flowed with each presentation was something which is remarkable. And to Prashant, just to tell you that it is not only the judiciary which is going to be made more accountable by the challenges that have been posed today to it, but defenders will feel extremely better protected with all that has been spoken here. The movement will grow, and this movement for protecting defenders across the country will be a more strengthened movement, judges, with what you have said. You have encouraged us to continue our struggles on the streets, because rights are won on the streets, and we will continue that path of fighting on the streets. Thank you very much. Thank you, Anjali. Thank you, Prashant. Thank you, judges. Thank you, participants, who came in large numbers, not only on the Zoom, but also on the other Facebook links. And I hope all these messages will be taking us to more struggles to ensure that ultimately these laws are really taken off board. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Sabhi ko zindabad.
Thank you. Thank you.